Peter, thank you for again joining me on an interview. This one's going to be a bit different. We're going to go back talking about your life. We've talked about a lot of things over the years, different subjects. Thanks for doing this, first of all. And
no problem, Chris. Anything for you, mate. You know how it is. Yeah. I was just saying earlier, every time we've done an interview lately, it's been on this settee, hasn't it? In the gym.
It's not a bad spot to do it. In my last interview, I did Kerry Kay's, and you said you watched that as well. And
I did. It was good listening to it. I can relate to everything he said about them times and what he was saying and stuff. You know, it was quite a deep interview from Kerry. He's a very truthful man, and he just says it as is. But when he was saying it, it brought a lot of memories back as well, them times, you know, because that's how things was back then.
We spoke about Kerry's sort of life, as in chapters and roles he'd played, and similar with you, you've had lots of different chapters in your life as well. But before we sort of go on to them, I want to sort of go back to the beginning, your environment growing up and your earliest childhood memories.
I've always said, yeah, I had a loving mother and father, and my memories are with them. And we had brothers when we was little, and we had a good... We had a very good childhood, to be fair. We had a very good childhood. You know, we went everywhere with my mother and father. They come back, you know, we'd be stopping in farmers' fields. We never really stopped too much with other travellers, really. You know, we'd be in farmers' fields, there'd be hay barns, we'd be playing in the hay and stuff. You know, it was good. You know, and then we did pull to like council traveller sites and stuff. Obviously, then we had to go to school, you know, because it was registered. Because obviously, they had to be registered to be there. And we got put in these schools and everything else. But it was all good. There was hard times, but very good times.
Where were you born?
I was born in Dewsbury in Yorkshire. Yeah.
And did your family, like you said, they travelled around different places? You ended up in Manchester. You've early years, you...
I first come to Manchester when I was about 13. And we moved up here in Partington. We stayed there for a few years. Or probably not even that, I don't know. Maybe a year or two. And, a good while. And, you know, that's where I met my missus and stuff. So life started from there, really.
Did your family and your mum and dad then live a traditional traveller lifestyle at that point when you was a kid?
They did. It was in trailers, you know. I know what people call them, caravans. We call them trailers, so living trailers. So we lived in them right up until I was married. And even when I was married myself in early years, I lived in caravans, you know. So, yeah, that was our way of life. That's the way we lived. And then when we got on, started buying bits of land and a house here and, building a house here maybe, buying and selling an house, you know. Everything else comes with it. But we started off in trailers, yeah.
Was it a happy childhood? Was it a happy family unit growing up?
Definitely, I'd say it was a happy family unit. I've not got nothing but good memories about it. You know, my mother and father, you know, God love them. They done the very best for us, you know. They worked hard every day. They looked after us. They always had us, no matter what we was, they always had us in decent clothes, you know. When I say decent clothes, clean. It was clean and tidy. It was presented tidy. You know, it wasn't like dragged up where we couldn't afford the shoes on our feet or anything. My mother and father worked, but they always looked after us. They put us first. They'd do without food themselves to look after the kids. It was all about that family, the children, the family, you know. That's how it was. So for me, I had the best parents in the world. To me, you know, there was. So, yeah.
What was your dad's name?
My dad's name was Hugh. They called him Huey, but it was H-U-G-H. You know, so my oldest brother, Huey, was named after him. So my mother was called Sissy. I've named my daughter after my mother. And there's a real name is like Patience, as in Patience. That was her name. And so I called my youngest daughter after my mother. And I've obviously got Huey, who was called after my father. Same as what I was, really. I was called after my grandfather on both sides. Yeah. Like, my name's Peter, my grandfather Fury was called Peter. And my grandfather's skeep was called Philip. So Peter Philip, like that. You know, so that's how it was. And probably a lot of other travellers have done the same thing. You know, just like passed down like that.
Fascinating. My family's like that, yeah. Your mum and dad then, what attributes do you take from each of your parents?
I take everything from my mother and father. You are your mother and father. And that's it, you know. So my father was a very... he was a very polite man. He, you know, money wasn't his god. He didn't care. As long as he had food in the cupboard, and he was decent, then he wouldn't spend his life saving money. He'd get money, spend it. Get money, spend it. He was an extravagant man. You know, go out to work with my mother. They'd get money. They'd come back. They'd cook food. But look, what better parents can you have? We had a breakfast, dinner, and tea every day. I can't remember not having it. We've never asked to bring money back, put it on the table. It never happened anyway, you know, because it's your mother and father, you know, they provided for us right up until we could fend for ourselves. There was always there. My mother and father was always there till the day they shut their eyes. They was always there for his family. Well, you get older, you get wiser, don't you? You know, we're all... You know, young men make mistakes. I've got lads here. You know, you're a father though, aren't you? They make mistakes, you check them. Because I've made mistakes. If you can't listen to your father, who are you going to listen to? So, you know, you can tell them, but sometimes they've got to learn and grow for themselves. You can only advise. You know, you can only be there for your kids. But I'm lucky. I've got good kids.
If you looked at a photograph on the sideboard in your mum and dad's house, it was a family picture, who would be on that picture? What was the immediate family you grew up with?
We'd be all on it, me three brothers, myself, and my mother and father.
So there's four of you?
Four of us, yeah.
Four brothers?
There's four of us, yeah. And we'd all be on them, you know, them photos. I've got them photos. Like I said, you know, you can't buy them, memories. Looking back, and now I'm in my 50s, definitely happiest times in my life they was. Not the happiest, because I've had lots of happy times, you know. You know, met my wife, my kids, stuff like that. So, you know, but being a young lad, you know, and my mother and father not being here anymore, you realise, you know, you just realise the weight of them when they're gone and how much they meant to you, you know.
Being... from a gypsy traveller culture and knowing that from a young age what you was about and what, you know, how did you feel that as a young person and knowing the whole culture and what it meant to be a Fury?
It's just a name to me. At the end of the day, I don't look at, you know, people stigmatise and they go like gypsies are ignorant or something. Certainly not an ignorant race of people. You know, you see... There's different grades of people in every walk of life, isn't there? You know, it's what you want to be yourself. You know, yeah, I've been in prisons and I've seen some proper educated twits. I call them like that. You know, where he had to get up. He was Einstein written on a piece of paper and nobody's looking at him. He had to get up and speak in front of people. And he's like, bup, 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 bup. Couldn't speak at all. Sweating and everything. I got up to talk for England. So... So, you know, education, you know, look, if you can't communicate, you're as educated as you want. So what I'm saying is, getting back to the gypsy thing, it's just name tags put on people. But we are travellers, the culture is different, and that's it. Everybody's got their own culture, you know, Jamaican, Chinese, black, white, yellow, whatever. Everybody's got their own culture, haven't they? But we're all the same. We're all the same.
You have, your life, you've ended up into boxing and you're a boxing coach, you box yourself. You were surrounded by that, Peter, wasn't you, from a young kid? Uncles who were fighters, bare knuckle fighting, boxers, your brothers boxed as well. So it was always around you, that, was it, from a young kid? And you know, having that, like a fighting legacy, if you like, of a family.
I'm going to tell you something now, I never really thought about it as a young kid. Yeah, we were surrounded by it. My father, you know, he wasn't a troublesome man. My dad was no barefist fighter, you know. He didn't like trouble. My dad looked the other way. My dad's in trouble, he'd say, you see them, keep away from them.
He'd steer you away from them.
He'd be yourself, you know. My father was totally dedicated to his wife and his children. He didn't need anything else, didn't want anything else. But all of his cousins was fighters, you know. He'd been in boxing booths up and down the country, holding spit buckets and stuff as a young kid.
So he was always around boxing. Yeah, so.
And he's trained around boxers as well, you know. And he's done a little bit himself, probably as a young fella, you know, just in and around his family. Because he comes from a family of, like, he's had cousins. His uncle was a champion boxer in and out the ring, you know. And his son boxed as well, had 34 or 5 pro fights. And my dad used to, like, go up and down with him in boxing booths and stuff, you know. And the things and the stories he'd tell and the jokes he'd tell was unbelievable. He said, I got down one day, he said, he's there. He said, and this cousin of mine is built like a brick shed house, he said. He looked like a bronze colour, you know. He said he was a lovely looking man, very smart man. He said, and this, he's fighting this kid, he said, with a white vest on. He said, this kid's about 10, 11 stone, he said. And he's like an Adonis at 13 and a half, 14 stone. And he gets in his boxing booth and he said, oh, are you ready? He said, yeah, I'm going to do him, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and you know. What he's not going to do and what he isn't going to do. He said, I bent down, put the spit bucket down, I've looked up, he said, and the cousin's on his back, counted out. You know, I laugh at these stories today, you know, and he tells me stuff. But on a serious note, he'd have fights again, the fella, and win them. You know, it was that's how it was back then, you know, but he does. He comes from a family of fighters, but he wasn't interested himself, you know, and... We always used to watch the fights. He put the radio on because sometimes we'd be stopping on places where there was no electric, you know, and we had radios. And if the telly wouldn't work, I remember one day if a fight was coming on. I was only young, I can't really remember. And he takes his telly to the television shop, gives this man the television. And all I remember, I don't know if I'm accurate saying this or not, but I remember this fella walking to the top of the stairs and throwing my dad's TV down a flight of steps and saying, that's what your TV's worth. It's unfixable. Yeah? So then we went home and my dad's playing with the aerial on the radio to get Muhammad Ali versus Joe Frazier, I think, in the 70s, early 70s. So yeah, that'd be right. Probably was around then. So yeah, he was passionate with the boxing. You know, listening to it, he'd be throwing punches in the radio. You know, so obviously, although it's not that he wasn't interested in it, I'm saying himself, he was quiet, but he was always surrounded by the sport. And we grew up surrounded by it as well.
Uncles and, yeah, bare knuckle fighters in the family as well. They were like pop stars within the culture as well, aren't they? Anyone who's a good bare knuckle fighter, yeah. They were held up in high esteem.
I know you're referring to old Bartley Gorman. You know what? He was such a character, him. He was, you get like one-offs. And he was like that. You know, he'd sit and the fire would be going, you know, and the next thing, he'd say, right, quiet, I'm going to give you a song. And he'd just spring into action. You know, that was him. You know, such a extraordinary fella, you know, and a very nice man as well. Again, he was a family man. But, you know, he was a ferocious man in his day. You know, he could fight badly. He boxed as well. So he knew how to train. He knew how to be super fit and stuff. So he could handle himself, yeah. His brother could as well, Sam.
Big Sam, yeah.
There was big fighting men them days, you know. You're looking at people there. I think Bartley was about 6'1", he was. 6'1", and he was about 15 stone eight. But solid. He was a big man, 15 stone eight. You know, he's a raw boned man. And he had a big red hair, curly hair. You know, that was him. And freckles all over him.
I read his book a couple of times, and he mentions you in it. You and Johnny fought an awful lot of years, and he mentions a few times in the book.
Yeah, I knew Bartley, you know, very well. And when he had the problem and he was ill, I went and took him out of Birmingham Hospital and took him over to Germany and tried to get him... Because they give up hope on him. He had cancer in his liver and stuff. And, you know, and we took him over there to see if we could help him out. And we spent a week over there with him. And then he just went into relapse. And then he come back and he passed away here in Derby. But he lived in Uttoxeter till the day he passed away, really.
Yeah. There's no age as well, was he, in his 50s?
I think Bartley was 56, 57, if I remember. He's around there. And his brother died 10 years to the day earlier, at the same age, but 47 or something. Same complaint. But their father had the same complaint and died the same way as well. Young.
Was Bartley on your dad's side?
On my father's side, yeah. Because me granny's a Gorman.
Yes.
My dad's mother. Okay. So it was my dad's mother's family.
Was your mum's side, did they have that background as well, as far as like the fighting background?
They did, yeah. My mother had relatives in London. They called them the Barrow Boys, you know, because my mother's from down south. And they used to fight also in boxing booths and fight for money on my mother's side. But I don't know much about them because I was always around my dad's people growing up. The only real people I seen on my mother's side was my mother's sister.
Do you know how your mum and dad met? How did they meet your mum and dad?
My mother and father met at Epsom Downs. You know, at a fair. And they seen each other years before and they got together some years later. And that was it. That's how they met. I said, all travellers probably met back then. They go to fairs and places. And that's how they met, yeah.
You mentioned to me about an uncle, was it Uriah, I think, he used to get you up every morning as a kid and he really instilled boxing discipline to you.
Oh no, he's not a blood uncle to me. But I remember when we first come to Manchester, Partington, was on his place, we stopped on his place. And it was all Uriah Burton, they called him Uwe. Yeah, so I spent quite a few good bit of times with him. Yeah, and he used to train with him every morning. And he reminded me a lot, that old fella, of Bartley Gorman. It was very similar. Very, very similar in their actions and the ways. They even looked a bit similar, to be honest. Because Bartley also was very bodily strong. And old Uwe was very strong as well. And he was some man as well, to be honest with you. Listen, I got a high respect for Bartley. You know, listen, my mother and father, they're the love of my life, so it's going to be like that. But old Uwe, I respected him as well. He was an old gentleman. And, you know, he could fight as well. He was a proper fighting man. He'd had a lot of fights on the street, old Uwe Burton. And he used to train with Jock McAvoy in Manchester. He had some ropes in a hay barn, and that'd be him, old-fashioned fella, you know. But he was an old-school throwback, old Uwe. He had a pair of trousers on, a belt, and, you know, he trained, hit at the bag for 25, 30 rounds. You know, he was one of them. He was a plodder, but he'd keep going. But a tough nut, you know. And me and him used to have a lot of conversations because I spent a lot of time with him. Because I think I got caught driving. I couldn't drive anywhere back then. You know, the police was looking at me back then. I was only about 14. Anyway, so I used to go up and down with him and he used to say, come with me, Peter. And, you know, I think he liked me, the old man, because I was game myself back then. I liked to fight, you know.
You could see the interest you had in it.
Yeah, and I was always in trouble as well. I was always fighting in the villagers' stuff. I'd be whipping the old man as they pull the van up and somebody would get two right-handers and a left hook, you know.
Really?
Because that's how it used to be back then. And always got on well with him. I did. And he used to get me, he'd say, right, throw these punches, yeah? And I'd say, listen, throw the punches. Throw the punches now. I won't tell you again. Anyway, so okay, gets his gloves on. And he'd have his hands up and he'd say, right, and you block like this and you do this and you do that. And then he'd grab and then he'd tussle you about, you know. And he'd say, listen, it's not just about throwing punches. You need to know how to grapple, he said, and get a man on the floor, you know. And he was like a wizard at that, you know. He'd have you tipped upside down. And I'm going back now, old Uwe, back then was in his, I don't know, he'd be 40s, in his early 40s probably, the time I'm talking, you know. But he was a very, very knowledgeable man. He knew he's fighting inside and out. And he was a good man at reading the future. Well, Uwe Burton was a very clever man. He wasn't like a man in prehistoric times. He was clever. He was a very clever, articulate man. And he was well-liked as well. Everybody around near Partington, wherever he was respected, old Uwe Burton. He was a good old-fashioned travelling fighting man, old Uwe. To his boots, that's what he was. So again, you know, I respect the old man.
Is that where the seed of boxing first was planted with you in them early years, with Uwe and Uriah and Bartley and knowing the culture around you and hearing the story of the old fighters. And
like yeah, said, and listen, the main thing I think with the boxing with the family was it was four brothers. You know, they liked it. The older brothers, they liked it. They always had a set of boxing gloves on, you know. And we always like move from place to place, go from gym to gym, do this type of stuff, you know. So it was always there roundabout. And what I do remember more than anything, actually, I remember my brother Huey, he was the eldest, and every Friday morning, that boxing news would be there. And when you looked in the cupboard, they'd be stacked up like that from the floor. He had every one, you know. So, it's always been in the family. Whether it's not me, my brothers, or whatever, it was always there. But I think the biggest boxing nut in the family was Huey, because he lived and breathed it. He lived and breathed it. He had fighting chickens. Yeah, had to have the pure fighting chickens, because if he wasn't pure in blood, it means he wouldn't fight to the death, and that was no good to him. He had to have a pure fighter. And then he had an American Pit Bull Terrier. He had to have a top fighting dog. He had a top fighting dog. Yeah. And then he liked fighting himself, you know, so, and he liked anything to do with boxing. He was an avid studier of it, and he was very intelligent as well, so. Yeah. So, yeah, growing up, family, my brothers, my mother and father, mainly. And my father obviously telling us stories, you know, when we got older. And like I said, I bumped into old Huey Burton and spent some good quality time with him. And, I did. I look back and I see these people and I see the likes of Bartley Gorman and the old-timers when... Old-timers to me back then, but those characters... I don't see them around today. They're not like that today. You know, they get up, they have a tap dance, they do stuff, you know. It's nice. There was like company people. You know, if there was a crowd of 200, a crowd of 300, they could perform. That's what it was like. They'd be the center of attention. They loved it, you know. Proper top personalities they was.
Did you very much stick together as family, or was there outside? Did you have other friends growing up, or was it very much family, an extended family?
Yeah, we had cousins and everything, but mainly it was about my mother and father and us brothers. But we had cousins. You know, I had aunts as well. You know, and they spent a lot of time with us, my dad's family. And I had, my mum's brother, my Uncle Jimmy and stuff. You know, my granny and granddad on my mother's side. You know, we've seen our direct relatives, if you know what I mean. We used to see them, we used to stop with them at times. And then a lot of time we stopped by ourselves. So yeah, I seen my granny and granddad on both sides. But the one that passed, the longest living one was my grandfather, Philip, on my mother's side. Because my granny, she died in the early 70s, I think 73, 74. On my mother's side, she passed away early. I was only a young kid, 4 or 5 year old. But I remember her still. Because we used to go and see them every week. You know, we'd be travelling up wherever we was. We'd be in the back of a van or the back of an old whatever, and we'd just go and see them. So that was it. We used to see, my father would have a week and go and see his family. If we never stopped with them, that is. And my mother would have the week after like that. We just say, well, you've seen your parents this week. I'm seeing mine this week, you know. Yeah. It was like that. But we always enjoyed it. We always enjoyed seeing them.
Did you like the old stories and of the grandparents? And
you know, when you're young like that, especially your grandparents, you know, it's your mother and father's family, isn't it? So you're going to be close to them. So, yeah, I remember them very well. We used to go to Wakefield Market, and my granny and grandfather, my mother's people, my father's people would be there in the cafe. Having a fry up, you know, and we'd just go there and meet them. It'd be like the highlight of the day, you know, stuff like that. I remember things like that. So, yeah, it was all good memories. But my grandfather on my father's side and on my grandfather's side was in the days where they had like 3-piece suits on. There's the gold pocket watch, the trilby hat on, the no collar on the shirt. It was that, you know, and the braces. It was like that, them times.
When you started getting into like the teenage years and the formative years and you're making your own way in the world, you know, what type of character was you in them teenage years? What were your hopes and dreams and what people were around you as you were you know, sort of the school leaving age, if you like?
Do you know, Chris, it's hard for me to even answer it. I really don't know. I don't think I could look too far into the future. I never really thought about it. I used to train every day when I was young, and I was more interested in probably, forget boxing, I was interested in fighting out there. You know, I was interested in stuff like that when I was younger. So I never really thought about anything else. You know, when I accidentally met the missus, you know, walking the dock. You know, I wasn't looking for a woman.
How old was you then when you met your wife?
I think I was about 14. 14, yeah, when I met the missus.
Love at first sight.
Yeah, we got on very well. We did.
It's been a successful relationship.
Listen, best memories of my life. Listen, we find somebody and that's it. And we met, seen each other for 2.5 years or something, and we got married. Yeah, good memories.
What was you doing in them times? What was you going to do for work? When you know, was you working within the family, or did you have your own ideas of what you wanted to do as a profession?
Listen, when I was a young lad, I didn't know whether to have a shit or a haircut. Yeah, I didn't know what the fuck I was going to do, to be honest with you. Sorry for the language, but I'm just telling you as it is. You know, I didn't know what to do. Am I going to go and cut a tree down? Am I going to do this? I'm going to... And then I'd look at it and think, well, I can't be bothered to do that. And then I wasn't of a lazy mentality either. You know, I'd do the work, but the opportunities wasn't there. You know, it's hard. It's hard to do something when you've got no help. Because, you know, my mother and father couldn't afford to do anything for us, and we wouldn't ask them anyway. So he was like, it's hard to get up and do something when you've got no money. You know, and you've got no help to do stuff. So it's difficult. So you're just treading water. And it's frustrating when you're younger because you don't know what to do either. And then all of a sudden, something happens and you click. I found my own way eventually. I found my own way from zero. So, like I said, I had the missus there. We wasn't married. And that was a highlight in my life, really. I used to train every day and go and see her once a week. Sometimes I'd see her once every 2 weeks because we moved from there. So I think we moved to Accrington in Lancashire from Partington here. So we was there. And obviously, my missus was here. And, I used to see her every couple of weeks. We go to the phone boxes and have a chat to remember it, you know. And that'd be it. Put 10 pence in the machine. So that was the way it was. But no, never anything. And then I started doing a few bits and pieces. And I don't know, it could have been my brother Jimmy, actually. I'd have to say it probably was Jimmy that got me. He said, why don't you sell some horse shit or something like that? Yeah, and do that. I think it was him. Because my brother Jimmy was married, I think he was about 17. He got married 17 as well. Anyway, so he said, this is what you do. So he told me what to do, so I remember. So I saved up £4, yeah, which took me about a month. Simple as that. I remember, like I said, and I used to sit there, and I was that bored and frustrated. The day had passed, I did a training, and I used to sit there throwing stones in a bucket. Thinking, what a fucking life this is. Yeah, what am I going to do? I mean, mind would be spinning everywhere. Yeah, and never used to speak to that many people. I was walking past in the village, and I sees a little van, and I go, knocks on the door, I said, look, mate, would you sell that van? He said, it's out of MOT. Yeah. I said, what do you want for it? He said, I want £75 for this van, yeah. And he was like, you might as well sell £7,500, yeah. Anyway, so I said, right. I said, I'll have it off you. Anyway, I done this, done that, went out, got some. It's surprising what you can do when you've got nothing, yeah. So I went doing anything I could, whatever. Sweeping a drive up, cutting a hedge down, getting a lawnmower out the back of somebody's shed, mowing the grass for an old OAP or something, you know, getting a few quid off on whatever I could do, yeah, in the village, walking, yeah. Kept going, knocking on his door, giving him a fiver, giving him £6, giving him £3 like that, yeah? The man kept laughing at me. He said, I'll tell you what, he says, you're a determined young fella, you. Anyway, I think I got about 40, I got to about 45, 50 pound. Man was sick of looking at me. He said, take the van. He said, I don't want to see you coming back here, knocking on my door. He said, take the van. And best of luck with you, yeah? He said, but don't get pulled up in it because no test on it. I said, yeah, don't worry about the test. Anyway, forget the test. Not interested in test myself. It had no tax, no insurance, zero on it, yeah? Anyway, next thing, goes again, saves up, gets some fuel money. Anyway, goes, finds the biggest cow shit dump I could ever find, yeah? Anyway, gets in these bags. And I never forget this. This is a very funny thing I'm going to tell you. And there was hard times, but the best of times as well. And I remember, and I put 90 pence of fuel in this van, in this little petrol Peugeot van, yeah? Anyway, I've got about 12 to 15 bags of horse shit in the back of this van. And it's like that. It's sat on its ass, yeah? And it's barely moving. The clutch is slipping in it. It's a piece of scrap. Anyway, I'm coaxing it to the top of this hill, yeah? Gets to the top of this hill, it's conked, hasn't it? I've got no money. I've got a van. If it conks out on the side of the road, the police are going to come. That's the end of the van. Yeah? And I've rolled it down the hill, and it's rolled into a big council estate. That's where I was heading. So I've gone into the council estate, yeah? And the van's conked out. So I've got no money in a minute's van. And I've got to tell you, I've got my hands on the steering wheel. It's pissing down the rain, yeah? And I thought to myself, and all the work I've done as well. I got in the van and I thought to myself, then times I felt a bit sorry for myself, you know? I was about 15, something about 15 year old. And gets out and I thought, and he was sick. Knocked on the door, nobody in. Knocks on the door, same again, nobody in. Anyway, I knocks on his door and a woman, or I can't remember if it was a woman or a man, anyway, come out. And he said, what type is it? I said, come and have a look. And he looked at it and he's messing with it in the back. I didn't understand it. To me, it's fucking horse shit, yeah. Anyway, he said, I'll tell you what. He said, how much is it? Now, I can't remember. I'd be lying if it was 50 pence a bag or a pound. It was one or the other. But he said, I'll take them. Couldn't believe it. Walking on air. I got them bags at the back of that van 100 mile an hour. To straight up that drive in the back of that man's place, yeah. And I said, listen, I said, do you want any more? He said, you know what? I will. He said, get me another 15, I'll have them off you. Well, that was it, wasn't it? So he's giving me 12 quid or 10, I can't remember, 10 or 15 pound or whatever. And that was it. I've gone skipping down the road with a petrol can. Gets the £2 in this van, yeah, tips it in the van, straight back. Yeah, holding the bag with one hand and a pitchfork, a shoveling the shit in with the other, and singing to myself, yeah, happiest man in the world, right? Goes back, and that was it. And I kept doing that from, I used to get up at 4 a.m. in the morning, and some days I'd come home about 9, 10 o'clock in the evening, because I'd bag up about 400 bags of this horse shit in these coal bags. They had the old cold bags back then, those plastic cold bags and them sacks as well. So I used to put it all in there. And, you know, and the fella come to me in the place and he said to me, he said, you're an unusual young fella. He said, never seen anything like it. Me and my missus watch you out here, he says. There's no water, there's nothing. He says, there's no food and you're there all day. He says, I've never seen anybody like it, he says. He says, if you're unsuccessful selling this shit, come back here. He said, I'll give you a job. He said, you're a machine. I thought, yeah, some machine. I thought, you don't realise, mate. When you've got no food and you're hungry, you'll do anything. Yeah, anyway, I got on. That was it. And I made myself a little bit of money and managed to get enough and get married with it. And then we got married and, and then we went on from there.
So from young, you always had a lot of endeavour and drive, quite entrepreneurship, really, which is shown in your later life.
Yeah, I've never been a person to roll over in my life. I've never give in. You know, if there's a massive mountain there, if I can't get through it, I'll get over it. Some way it's got to happen somewhere. Don't ask me how, but somewhere. I've always had that belief anyway. I've lived like that. And I've took ridiculous chances. What people could only, they'd never do. Anybody with a brain cell wouldn't do. But I've took them, you know, because that's your mindset. That's the way I was back then.
You was happy to take a chance when you was that age and see what came of it.
Listen, if somebody said to me there's 100,000 and they're going to pull the trigger and try and miss it, I'd think, well, is there a good chance of missing it? You know what I mean? Obviously, I'd probably say no in the end, but I'd really consider it. I'd have to, you know, it was like that. You know, is it possible I could miss it, you know? Maybe be a bit quicker than the bullet, I don't know. You know, when you're young, you're naive to a lot of things, aren't you?
Did the horseman your business and did you think, well, I can do something here with this? Did you carry on that for a long time or did that make you think, well, if I can do this, I can do other things, make other things work?
Yeah, it just fizzled out. I remember I got married and started doing something. When I got married, my missus was a big help to me, to be fair. She said, why don't you have a look for some metals and stuff? I said, well, I don't know about any metal. Anyway, I started doing a few things, you know, getting a few scrap cars and weighing them in and stuff. Done all of that. And I seen this stainless steel, I don't know what it was, like shavings in a skip. Anyway, I suppose I got a little bit lucky as well. And I got this and I had a pickup for about 300 quid. Anyway, I stacked it on this pickup and weighed in and I never seen anything like it. I got about 1,800 quid back then, you know. So now I'm a millionaire, right, Chris, you know, from having £2.50, I've now gone out one day's work, yeah. Well, it took me a year to earn 1,200 quid, by the way, yeah. Now I've gone out in one day and I've got 1,800 pounds for whatever, for some of these stainless steel shavings, whatever they are. So, yeah, started doing stuff like that. And then I met some people and he said, I sent some motors for sale on the car front. And I started speaking to him and he says, no, they're not mine. He said, I sell them for people. I said, yeah. I said, could you sell that truck? Yeah, he said, sell that truck. He said, but it needs painting. He said, it's scabby. He said, it needs painting. You know, seats need doing. He said, but yeah, I could sell it. I said, well, how much could you sell it for then? Oh, I could make about 1,300 pounds of it or something. And that was, and from there then, that was it. Because I'd only give 200 or 300 quid for this thing. So I got it painted for 100 quid, messed around with the seats, you know, tarted it up a bit, put it on this sale court. He took 100 quid, and I got the money back. And then I went and bought something else, and I bought two, bought three. Carried on from there.
How did you look at the future at a point? When you just got married, you're setting out on the road, you work, career, trying different things. You know, how did you look at the future from that young man?
I never really took a lot of thought in it. We just worked and, you know, had my family around me. It was me and the missus.
Good team, you and your wife.
Yeah, definitely.
Good team.
We worked together when we were young. You know, she helped me and gave me good advice as well. Yeah. Listen, she was a worker, you know. I used to see her and, you know, she'd have a hammer and chisel in her hand for stripping a dynamo for some copper out of it. So she was not shy of work. One of these where, you know, do you want a cup of tea, do it yourself. You know, none of that shit, you know what I'm saying? I had a woman to look after me properly and she looked after me like a baby, actually. It was the best time of my life. It was hard when I was growing up. When I got the wife, I thought I was in heaven. Clothes washed, everything done for me. Couldn't believe it. I thought, this'll do. Paradise. I thought, I'm getting money, married, lovely, happy. You know?
A comfortable home life like that.
Comfortable home life.
Helps
you, know,
you to succeed in what you want to do.
That's why I always say to me boys, get a good woman and don't bother at all. There's plenty of shit out there. Yeah? Isn't there? My pal, Mickey McAvoy, said to me, God rest his soul, right? He said, listen, son. You get meat pies anywhere. He said, but you can't get a fucking good steak anywhere. He said, go for quality over quantity. And it's true. You know, if they can find themselves good women, it's a very good start in life. Because I can only speak from my own experience, you know, because without her being at the back of me back then, I wouldn't have probably achieved anything. But I had a purpose in life, you know, and she gave me that purpose in life to get forward. So it was, that's the way it was. And I try and instill in my own kids the same thing. Just get somebody that's, you know, who wants a money grabber, who wants a piece of ass, mutton dressed up as lamb, you know. Get a proper, decent young woman, you know. Anybody can go and get an old slut down the road. Who wants that? Get something properly that you can spend the rest of your life with.
As a team, work together.
As a team. I'm talking crude because that's the way it is. Because if you don't get proper people, you're not going to get loyalty out of a brick, are you? You know what I mean? It's a kind of luncheon meat. It's fucking 10 a penny, isn't it? There's loyalty there.
When did you start a family? What was your first children born?
19. I had my first daughter. I was about 19, 18, 19, I think. 16, 17, yeah. Married at 16. 2 months short of 17. So I was no more 17, really. And then 18, 19, yeah. I was married for a couple of years. And then we had the eldest daughter. And then I think there's a year or maybe a bit in between them. I had another daughter, and then a son, and then a son, and a son. And then a long time in prison, a daughter. And that's it. Six in the end.
That gives you a newfound focus when you have children, doesn't it? It changes your whole perspective on life. And when you and your wife Maureen, you had your first child again. What stage was you at there in your life, and what was you doing when sort of shit gets serious? Here we've got a kid to feed, not just ourselves. And you know, what was your mindset then? Where was
I had my head screwed on back then. You know, I was pretty successful in business. I had my mother and father around me.
What was you doing then in business at that point then?
I was buying and selling. I was in the motor trade.
You'd gone into motors?
Yeah, heavily into the motor trade.
From that first van then, you ended up getting some proper ones.
Yeah, I think I had about up to nearly 200 vehicles on a site.
How did you get into that?
By doing what I've done. Like I said to you, you know, I met that fella. I started putting motors on a car pitch.
From that one.
And, you know, and then I got a car pitch myself. And then instead of just doing five or six with him, I ended up putting 50 on a car pitch. And then from a car pitch, they said I couldn't have the planning. And then I bought a big industrial estate yard, you know, 2 acres, and filled that up, you know. And then I started doing all of that. So, yeah, things was good. Money was there, houses, cars, whatever. And, the first thing, you know, my mother and father's always been more than good to us anyway. So as soon as I got on, my mother and father never wanted for anything. Yeah. I said, listen, goodbye to the trailer. There's a new bungalow, get in there, you know. So that was it. So they had my mother and father, they shared in what I had anyway. So I made sure my direct family was right. And it was... And it was the best thing ever done in my life because my mother and father, like, next door. You know what I mean? So wherever I was, they was next door. If I moved somewhere, I'd take them with me. You know, so I had the wife and kids, and to me mum and dad. So I took my mother and father everywhere, you know. And that's how it was.
A nice thing to do. I'm great to do that, get to that point where you could say, no, mum and dad, they'll look after you.
My old mother, you know, my dad passed away in 2002. But my old mother, you know, they was living in a house by themselves together. And then when my father passed away, I got my mother and she moved in with us. So my mother was like, I come home and she'd be in the living room, you know, sat there. You know, and that's how we had it back then, you know. So not so far off. And my mother passed away, you know, in the house with us. You know, so my mother and father was with me till the last breath, to be honest. They never left me far, and I never left them.
Did the right thing.
You've only got one mum and dad, haven't you?
you know, you said that you're setting up a business. You've got a very successful business here. I mean, hard work wasn't something you shied away from. You've said that, but you've got to be very clever as well and quite astute to get to a level where you're running a very successful business. You must presume you had people working for you, and you know, did you know you always had that sort of entrepreneurial spirit, and did you know how business worked, or did it all evolve for you and you learned it on the job?
I wouldn't say it was just me. I think every back in my time of life, in my generation, it was like all young travelling lads got to live in the same way. There's a lot of clever people out there. It wasn't just myself. But yeah, I got on, made money from nothing, and was comfortable. And we had plenty of money when I was younger.
At what point then, when you've got this successful car business, do you end up doing other things that took your life in a total different direction?
Yeah, listen, you can take the wrong turn, can't you? You know, got a bit bored with life and stuff, and I had millions of pounds around me, and I thought, well, if this is the money, you know, what's left in your early 20s, you know? And I thought, right, nobody's ever done this before, I'll do that.
So early 20s, you're a millionaire already.
Yeah. I had plenty of money, yeah.
Looking for other things, other challenges then maybe at that point, other things to do?
Probably, you know, if I'd have had a proper brain cell, I'd have been a clever man, wouldn't I? And stuck and listened to the missus. If I'd listened to the missus, yeah, I'd probably be a billionaire today, wouldn't I? But, you know, you don't listen, do you?
Do you remember that moment? Do you remember that exact moment when you sort of looked that way a bit, when you looked away from what you actually had and thought, I'll try that? Do you remember that moment when you had that choice to go one way or the other?
I had plenty of choices. I didn't need to do anything. I had money anyway.
What was it then? Why did you?
Probably bored and just fed up and looking for something else and excitement or whatever. Young, aren't you? You know? And that's it. Definitely took the wrong road anyway. Definitely veered off sharp to the left.
You told me once you were sat there one day and you said, you know what? I'm going to run a city. I'm going to take over a city. You was in a position where people would come to you to look after them, and then they'd ask you to look after an area, and then you went on to look after what you, in your words, looking after cities. How does it go from that to you getting onto that level and having that status in that field where you can do that?
I think when you're in something, you don't sit and think about it. You're in the fast lane, aren't you? So things are moving at pace. You know, there was violence, plenty of money, and you had to deal with things properly. And that's what we did.
What was the attraction to it? Was it money or the risk of it or the fun of it?
Well, both, because I thought to myself, you know, why have 3, 4, 5 million, whatever it was, I don't know, millions, and I can probably earn myself 2 million a week. You know, so I'll go for the 2 million a week. And if anybody gets in my way, I'll deal with them because it's free money. I like to have a fight anyway. So there's nothing for me, was it? Go and punch somebody up and get £600-700. Do you know what I mean? And a cheeky bastard at that, so it wasn't a problem for me, was it? You know, so listen, it was a seedy world, all that job. It is what it is, isn't it? You're dealing with this type. You've got to be able to deal with them. Is it right to deal with them? No. So you're asking me what it was back then, you know. Today, just drive past in the car, I wouldn't give a second thought.
Things that you look back on with regret and you want to
do. Yeah, I shouldn't have got involved in any of it, to be fair. I've got no, I don't want to big it up and say it's this, that and the other than what it is. I must have wanted my head testing. I've got millions of pounds. I've got a good family around me. Why do I want to go mess with a bunch of fucking idiots? You know, but maybe there was a violent nature to me. I don't listen. I enjoyed dealing with them anyway. They didn't pay me. I used to deal with them. Target practice for me back then. You know, I enjoyed it. You know, they'd stand up to it to be clever, you know, and they'd get dealt with. And that was it.
And then it goes on to a different level altogether where you become one of the most wanted.
Probably, I wouldn't say most wanted, like I'm wanted by there's a bounty on me, I don't think like that. But I was wanted in a high regard where they wanted to give me serious prison. And they was looking for evidence, the best way they could do it. You know, people.
Yeah.
This is what I mean. You can be the best person in the world to somebody. I had a fella on from having zero, yeah, from having nothing. And he used to say to me, I'll never forget it. He was a big lump, yeah. And he said to me, listen, if you want me, I'll do everything for you. If you want the legs blowing off, I'll go and do it, you know, and do anything. Like, he wasn't afraid of the law, yeah. Well, now, looking back, I can see why he wasn't afraid of the law, because he was working with them, yeah. Anyway, this fella, he must have been, from on nothing, he was on thousands of pounds a week. Yeah. Anyway, and then eventually he set it up, and he they had like a hit squad, and that was it. Yeah.
You've seen all sorts. So heard all sorts.
He led me, this so-called best pal of mine. He led me to my demise, didn't he?
So he became your best friend, and he was.
Sure, listen, he trusted him. He said to me, listen, you need anything dealing with, and things I can't even discuss on camera, but, you know, he was, he couldn't do enough. You know, like a loyal dog there. Yeah. Do anything. And I mean, prepared to do anything. But look what he did.
And you had no inclination of that whatsoever at the time?
Obviously not. No. I didn't even have any inclination until I was about 3 or 4 years into the sentence. Did it that well. But everything comes out in the end, doesn't it? I've seen a lot of stuff. Human nature, I've seen it in all the shapes and forms it can possibly be in, because I've been in that situations myself.
All sorts of characters, different people you have to deal with.
Listen, there's been some serious people as well. I've not heard about, like, local druggies and stuff, what they are, aren't they? They need help more than anything. Today I'd look at it and say, they need rehab or something, I don't know. But back then, on that level, it's different.
You had to deal in some, yeah.
You deal with it, yeah. I wasn't a good person back then, and you pay a price for it. And I've paid, done all the jail, and I've done all of that. But listen, if you've got a... when I was categorised as dangerous, it wasn't because I was physically dangerous. It's because of the connections, your intelligence, and how you can get things done, you know. So then you're deemed as exceptionally dangerous, you know, and that's what it always was. And it was even like that up until my 40s, late 40s. It was only 2 or 3 years back. I was in the Liverpool Deco. Anything you know on this man? You know, reward, big reward. Only 2 or 3 years ago. Christ Almighty, been well retired from years upon years. Yet. So this is what I mean. It can live with you to a degree.
Do you remember that moment when you knew it was kind of, they were on you, or it was up, and you had to face the consequences?
I didn't really care back then about all that, to be fair. Listen, it's a good job I got the 10 anyway. I got nothing against the police. I got nothing against anybody. I got what I deserved anyway. And, you know, really looking back, it saved my life anyway. Because, you know, my father said, you're either going to end up dead or doing a lifetime in prison. Because there was no bounds, there was no stops anyway. I'd have just kept going. So they'd done me a big favour.
Was it hard for your mum and dad to see that?
Definitely, I must have put my mum and dad through hell and back, you know, because I was a good son in one regard, but a disaster on the other for them, you know. So it wasn't good for my dear old mother and father. So there's regrets there. We've all got to pay a price when you make mistakes. That's why I say to my own sons, and you know, you advise them, don't you? You learn from your own mistakes. And that's it, you do the best you can. But I've been wrote off, I've been on death's door many times, and I've come back. So, even to be sitting here, so it's a miracle. Don't ask me how I've got you, because I can't tell you.
You say death's door, you mean situations you've been in?
I've been in death situations, yeah. I've had guns go off at close range, I've had all kinds of things on enemy lines. So, I'm still here. Don't ask me how. A couple of guns jammed, you know? Never went off. One went off above me head and I was stone deaf. I couldn't hear a thing for days. All I could hear was ringing, like a doorbell. So, yeah, I've had some close skirmishes, yeah. And I've had some good hidings as well, when nobody's been there. I've had 4 or 5 on my neck, and me pals run up the road. All I can see is his shoes kicking his ass where he's running that fast, while I'm getting kicked to pieces. So I've had that as well. So I've had a lot of things go on. But it is what it is, isn't it?
When you finally, you got the police got you, and you had to go through the court case, and you had to do all that. How did you approach that? And I was at the time, knowing that, you know, you had the kids and your wife and the businesses, and then all of a sudden, then you've got to, you know, face this trial.
I was green back then. I hadn't done any jail, so didn't realise what I was up against. So when I got the prison, all I was thinking about, I thought about wife and kids. I wanted to get home to them, you know. And I've got lawyers telling me, just go not guilty, we'll get you off with it. Load of shit, you know. Bank to rights, found guilty, 10 years. I got a year of kilo for Class B drugs. I think got the highest sentence ever for 10 kilos of Class B speed. You know, give me a year of kilo. He told me, I'm giving you the highest sentence you can possibly get, and that's what I got. Me co-accused, Frank Smith. When we was in the police station, they offered me co-accused a deal. And he said to Frank Smith, we're not interested in you, mate. We want your boss there next door. So roll on in, yeah? We'll let you and your son go free. And he said, that's not happening. So when we come to get sentenced, so we're in the dock, when it come down to the co-accused, he went, You're protecting your lieutenant, yeah? You can get the same. Or some of them words are used. So we got 10 as well. Yeah. So yeah, we got 10 apiece. So, and then when I remember I had all this police escort with all the razzmatazz with it, their guns and all that, you know. And I was took straight from Manchester Crown, straight to Full Sutton High Security Unit. All the prison. So, yeah.
When you say amphetamines, is that like bringing it in to the country? Is it a network of people you got involved with? Was it something you instigated?
Yeah, we got importation and all that. You know, got done for the importation of it and whatnot. Bringing it in from Belgium, I think. Yeah.
So you go through you're on remand, you're going through the cut, and then eventually the sentencing, they give you 10 years.
Yeah.
Straight down, straight in.
Straight down. Like on that Monopoly board.
Not past goal.
Not past goal, straight in. Yeah. And that's it. You just got to get on with it.
Your first night, you're a millionaire. You've got a successful business.
Family. I was a millionaire. I wasn't a millionaire when I got to 10. I was on £6 a week. So it was a big fall from grace, wasn't it? Big,
yeah. First night in there, you're there on your own, you lay there in that cell. What's going through your mind?
I think what goes through your mind, you know, you've got it to do, haven't you? I realised I wasn't going anywhere for 6-7 years, so. But I'd already done a fair bit on remand, sorry. So probably I'd done about 14 months, 15 months on remand. So that helped. So I had roughly 5 and a half years left, somewhere like that. Which, yeah, it's a long time, isn't it, in a cell?
Did you know you had to get in a certain mindset to get through it, to do that other 5 years, knowing that, you know, you had a life out of there? So anyone who's never had to do that and to know that you've got all that time ahead of you, what do you have to do? Where do you have to put your mind?
Listen, I tried to be calm in there, but, you know, the type of people in there struggled with that. You know, I think the first day I was in there, somebody got punched in the mouth. Yeah. You know, so, and then I went on the wing and somebody else got an eye in. And then another four got an eye in. You know, so I was up for a problem, especially with idiots. So, I got warned, I got tucked out in the block a lot of times and this and that. You know, so.
Solitary and all that, mate.
No, that was more or less on remand. On the solitary, I never got. That was on remand. I've done a lot of. I've done all the remand in the solitary confinement, from block to block.
How does that look like, solitary confinement, for all that time?
You ain't got anything, have you? Sometimes you're 24 hours banged up in the block. It's block to block because back then they couldn't house me because with the high to the risk. So they used to have me in the blocks. So I done it in Manchester block, and then moved from there. And they moved me. Every 28 days, I got moved around in case I staged an armed breakout, and a lot of prison officers or whatever got killed, and police officers and all that. So that's what they say. So that's why they move you 28 every 28 days, especially when they did. They had me down as running and controlling an army, so and I, you know, arms and everything else to go with it. So you know, so they're gonna make sure I'm in a bank vault, you know. So cut communication, make sure you move every 28 days. And I think the longest I was in a place was in Durham, in the unit there. I spent quite a bit there, and I spent about four months in Liverpool Block on Hornby Road. I was there. And, yeah.
Did your reputation go before you went in prison? Did people know who you was when you were in there? And did you know a lot of people who were in there?
Say reputation. I don't know if people knew me or not. I know I didn't really know anybody when I went there. But you know, news travels fast. I did know of people, obviously, and there was people from my area already doing life sentences. That was in there, you know. So, but it was on other wings, and you know, it wasn't a good thing having them round me at the time, because they'd move me in like that if they thought, oh, he's got palsy, you know. We'll move this bastard, you know, like that. But still, we've still got to see each other and have a chat and stuff. And so I did know people, yeah.
You had to share a cell with all different types of people as well.
No, it wasn't
good
allowed.
And bad, was it? Or you were on your own?
Because it was, it'd be too dangerous on me file, especially with sex offenders. Because I took an oath anyway when I went in there. Put me near a sex offender. I said, I'll kill him straight out. I said, so don't put anyone near me. I said, because I'll do them in. I said, let's just... Because they said to me, they said, look, the dossier that's come with you, Peter, is horrific. Yeah. So they said, you know, what we're going to do? They said, look... And I never forget these words he said to me, this fella. And I got, this is a day. And anyway, I can't remember anyway. But he said to me, we'll do a deal with you. Yeah. You can see your wife and your kids. I won't stop your visits. You can have your visits. Yeah. And you play ball with us. You know, keep the peace in the prison. We'll have an easy life and you have an easy life. I said, yeah, that's fine then. As long as I get me visits, I'm happy. I said, if I don't get me visits, there's going to be a fucking, there'll be hell on earth to play. 24/7, you know. So he said, no problem. So we had a bit of a an agreement, an handshake on it, and that's it. So I kept the peace mainly because obviously I didn't want to lose my visits, you know, because you've got nothing in there, have you? You've only got your family outside. So I used to live to the visits. That was it. And my phone calls. So I'd be on my best behaviour because I've got the visits and the phone calls. If I never had the visits and the phone calls, I probably would have not been getting out. I'd have been getting extra charges in there, you know. But the family, like I said, I've got a lot to thank the family for, because without them, I'd have just been tipped upside down, because I'd have just went one extreme to the other. You know? So basically, no, I never bothered with people in there. You know, I kept myself to myself until somebody got cheeky with me or something or done something, and then there'd be an issue, obviously. Yeah. And I did have some skirmishes in there. It'd be wrong to say I'd never. But, you know, not on a daily occurrence.
And you had a job in there. You got your head down. Did you think, well, you know, this is reality. You know, you're quite a logical person. I'm going to find the best way to get through it. Did you also regret what you'd done at that point? Or
I had no regrets about anything. I thought to myself, you know, if I've got to do 6.5 years, everybody's going to pay. You know, I'll do tenfold when I get out. It was that mentality. Not, you know, I used to look at people and think, you know, and see how it was when I was out, you know, kissing your ass and stuff, and then nowhere to be seen, you know.
When you really need them.
I've done a lot of stuff. And some people, you know, had even robbed money while I was in there. You know, like it's clever. you know, and twist it and say all this, you know. And I took all this on board. And basically, that's where we are. But that's prison. That's not just happened to me. That happens to everybody. Because you've got fair weather friends. Because a lot of criminals are like that. You know. But there's a lot of old school people as well who's got high moral values as well. But like it comes down, there's quality over shit, isn't there? But there's plenty of shit everywhere. Whether it be in your criminal circles or in, can be MPs, can be any circle, can't it? Yeah, it's good and bad in all walks of life, isn't it? And I found plenty of bad, and I found a few good, and a few good, I kept them.
Get the good stick. Mm. You actually did another sentence as well, didn't you, after that? You had to, you come out after that, and then, what was the time frame in that?
So I went in 94 and I come out in, I think, just before the, was it 2000 or 2001? I think 2000. Was it October 99 or 2000, I think? I don't know, anyway. I come out around there. And went abroad, come back, had an 18-month surveillance thing going on, and got arrested again. And put on Kate again for 2 years. Fighting another 6 or 7 charges, yeah. That totaled to about 33, 34 years or something, maybe 36.
So tasting that freedom and then it's taken away from you again.
You know what I found strange? Yeah. All them years in the 90s, I was only there in strange ways for about 4 weeks, and then 3 or 4 weeks, and then I was made, then I went up, as soon as I went down to the Home Office, degraded me, and that was it, I was carted everywhere. But when I went back in 2006, I went back on this, obviously back in, and obviously the screws at Manchester said, oh, welcome back. Yeah. I said, yeah, where am I going? He said, here, where do you think you're going? He said, you're going straight on Carte. Yeah. You're always going to be a Carte, so you're going back on a Carte. So I said, no problem. Anyway, back on the Carte. I'll never forget. And I looked, and I'm looking at the staircase, yeah? This green staircase with a cobweb in it and a speck of paint off it. It was the same cobweb, the same speck of paint in fucking 1994, and now I'm in 2006, yeah? And I looked at it, and I thought to myself, fuck's sake. This is what I mean. So how can you judge time? Time stands still in there. So I remember that.
You told me you read a lot. Did you do things to, like that, to obviously to keep yourself occupied and busy, but you learnt a lot, and you fought your own case as well eventually, and you know, faith played a big part in you.
100%. You know what? I'll tell you a little bit of a funny thing here. I'm in Liverpool block on remand. So I've got Eddie Richardson next door. And I mentioned this because I was at a funeral the other day because my pal Mick died, and old Eddie Richardson was there. And you know what? I didn't recognise him because he was on a walking stick, you know, but I missed him. But I'm sure, hopefully, I'll catch up with him again. But anyway, so what happened was, he's in a cell, and every time I'm going to the phone, they'd open his door, and he'd have a big painting like that. And old Eddie would be painting in the cell. So anyway, he gets a message to me anyway, so I sees him out on the yard. Yeah. So he was doing the painting and I was reading Robert De Bruce, the book I touched on. Yeah. So I got this book, Robert De Bruce, the King of Scots, yeah, this 1,800 pages, whatever it was. So I was reading that and he was doing his painting next door. So we spent a good, I don't know, a few months. And I think he got moved, he went down to, from there, I don't know where he went. He could have went to Parkhurst or whatever, or maybe Whitemore. He was on a lie down anyway, because he was doing, all that he was doing, 25. Yeah. Good painter he was. Mm. I didn't forget looking at his painting. I thought, he can definitely paint, he can.
So there's about some characters you met, there were some good people you met in there as well. And
100%, there were some good people in there, in the same position as myself. Yeah. Good people.
You've told me in the past, actually, and I don't, if you mind talking about it, you was at a position where your case was you was looking like these years, and you decided one night to look in a book that was with you, and you found some papers. And, you know, faith is a big part of your life, and you had a spiritual experience. Would you mind talking about that, when you saw a light one night?
Do you know what it is? I don't really want to go into too much detail about my private, like, very personal things, but but listen.
Something clicked there in your mind one night.
Something clicked 100%, and you know what? It's and I found something. I had about 18,000 exhibits in the cell. You know, I couldn't even walk in the cell like that way. I had to walk in sideways. There was even on the top bunk of the bed. The cell was full of boxes, papers. Full of these papers, yeah. Anyway, so try looking through 18,000 papers. You know, there was like one of these little stacking forklift things coming up to the cell, wheeling them in, yeah. Anyway, so I've read all these papers over a period of 18 months, whatever, nowhere. And I had Henry Milner come up to see me. I've got him from London. And he said, look, you got to stand trial. He says, and he said, it's going to be, he says, and he puts this like tape recorder on the table. I said, what's that for? He says, well, he says, you need to speak and come over well to the jury. So I said, hang on a minute. I said, public enemy number one in every newspaper in Britain. I'm going to go to the jury and give a good statement. I'm charged with drugs again. Yeah. I've done 10 years for drugs. I said, I'm charged with a multiple string of offences. Where do you think I'm going? Where do you think I'm going? I said, thanks for your services. Yeah. I said, but you've done all you can. I said, he said, what do you mean? I said, don't need you anymore. So off he went. And I went through about 6 or 7 barristers anyway. You know, and had some good advice from barristers. And some barristers from here, Manchester, said to me, and I'll never forget it, and I'll probably listen to this interview. And he said to me, he said, Peter, for us to fight for you properly, I've got a wife, I've got children, they're in school. Private school. He says, I'll have no career left. He said, can you see how heavy it is? So I says, yeah. I said, well, thanks for telling me, I said, I appreciate it. As a matter of fact, I respect that more than any of us. So we had a coffee and we broke a Kit Kat together. And that was the last I seen of him. Yeah, so anyway, so and then I got somebody else who was like super intelligent. And I mean very, very clever. And he put some ideas in my head, and you know, look, and he said to me, you're only as good as the client. You know, and he was like a not give a fuck attitude. You know, he had nothing to lose, he was struck off. Yeah. And he was perfect. He talked my language. Because you know what he said to me? He says, you're a fighter, aren't you? I said, too fucking right. I said, yeah. He said, well, fight back then. I said, yeah, how? Well, he said, look at this, look at this, look at this. And he was planting seeds in my mind, you know. And that was it. He put that in my mind. Then I started going all the way through it. But I was a lot more wiser then, the second time around. I wasn't a fool. You know, I knew how the system worked. I knew what the police was doing, and I knew who was behind it. I knew who would be giving them snippets of information. You know, back then it was like even people around me I knew was half no good. I'd keep them close to me anyway. Do you know what I mean? So then it become a game of chess. It comes like that. I know who's who. I'm not an idiot. Yeah. And I'd say something to that person, oh, it's going to go back, person. That person's going to go back and deliver it over there. So it comes all that then. So basically, it's a minefield. It's a minefield that a lot of people don't belong in it. It's not a thuggery thing with tats and a whatever and a pair of muscles and a pair of big arms. On high level, it's intelligent people. And they're intelligent, the police, because they've got to be intelligent to catch an intelligent person, haven't they? So then they do whatever they got to do. But look, there's no Mr. Cleverness. I'm not trying to be clever or be anything, because if I wasn't involved in any of it, then I don't need a clever policeman to come and get me, do I? So That's how it, that's trying to explain it and simplify it down. That's how it is.
You,
what
you,
it was.
Do you want to get a drink of water, Pete?
No, I always, I always cough from time to time. People think I'm dying, by the way, but I'm not.
Looking at your case overall and almost like taking charge of it yourself and saying, I'm going to look at this and find out what's been said. It took you.
I found some papers, yeah, with the biggest motherfuckers on the planet. Again, yeah, this is these people. I'm not going to give no names because I'm a man of faith and I don't want to upset anybody. I'm not going to give no names or whatever. Comes to me. These fuckers had me baby, had the kids on the knees, yeah, when they were small, yeah. Comes to me one day, Peter, you know, I've been had over for 60,000 euros, yeah. I said, who's had you over? I said, no problem. I said, give that money back because I'll break your arms and legs, yeah. I said, as a matter of fact, you'd be selling your house, get the money back. The money was back to him 24 hours later, yeah. I said, give him some interest on top, yeah, for taking it. Anyway, they got the money back to something other. What do we owe you? I said, nothing, I said. I said, I know you, as I said. It's no problem for me, I said. You can have the money back. Yeah. These very people, yeah, done the damage. Put me behind that door for 2 years. These very people got me involved with drugs, which wasn't my drugs in the first place anyway. Yeah. It's all a load of shit. It made up by them. And I... You know, and I got onto it in the end because I looked at everything. I was looking at everybody, but I couldn't weigh it up. But this bastard had used his wife's phone. And that's how I found it. I found her phone. And her number matched this number, which was ringing me, which they said was the main person involved in his drug thing. And they said they didn't know it. Police said they didn't know who it was. They give you some alias name or whatever. Yeah. If you didn't know who he was, then what about this fucker's wife that rang for 2.5 minutes on that phone? So it unraveled very, started to unravel very fast. Yeah. And that's it. And then I had a dilemma and he said to me, look, make a defense, a DCS to call it, make a defense case statement. And you know, you make a statement and he gets pulled in and you're wrong, then you could be called a wrong one as well. Because he could be arrested, put in the dock next to you, then how's that going to make you look? But this is before I found the number. I had my suspicions of these people. I'd done about 14 months, and I kept saying to the lawyer, I said, you see them? Something not right with them, I said. I said, I think there's something around them. Because we all got arrested at the same time, and they got arrested and let out 2 days later. It was almost like, it was like a gimmick to make it look like there's a problem, and they're on bail. Well, that's a lot of shit. Serious people like myself go straight behind the fucking door. I'm responsible to end up dragged on your neck at 5 a.m. You're in. Do you understand? So basically, these fuckers has got bail. So I'm looking at it. No proof, though. But I'm swirling it around in my mind. And eventually, I found it. I found his wife linking up here. And and then it all started crashing down. And then there was something on... Probes, they called it, which is intrusive surveillance, where they do the cars and stuff, and they bug up the properties and whatnot, so they can do all of this surveillance. And they said they only had 40 hours. Well, don't take Einstein to realise you're public enemy number one, subject one in the UK. Yeah, because when we got all the intelligence, it was there. Yeah, come out when I was inside. So when I've looked at all of this, and I get off the plane for 18 months. Why is it going to be only 40 hours on subject one? There's not going to be 40 hours, is there? They turned out to be over 440 hours. Yeah? So at this stage now, I'm at the 22 months stage. The drugs is gone, because obviously they're not going to go and give him and his missus with it, are they? So they've had to drop it, because otherwise, what are they going to do? So their assistance now... It's gone, so the drugs have gone out the window. Yeah, so now I'm left with this. And the judge, I had a very good judge at the end of the day. And he said, you know, this clearly isn't right, is it? He said, look how long he's been in. So I got so I got bail out of the Cate, out of Strange Ways. So I got out and back with the family. And And this person, I'd listen, it was a, it was, this is a life you definitely don't want to be in. That's why I say it don't pay. I haven't been home one day. I get home in the evening. Yeah. Next thing, door knocks. It's only this fucker's wife that's come to front it up. Because what she thought is she's obviously been sent to see me. Yeah. And seeing how the land lies with it. So she come down, she sat there, and I just said, listen, you're no good cunt. That's what you are. I said, and if it wasn't for my wife and kids, I said, I'd get a bullet, I said, I'll put it right between your two eyes. I said, and wouldn't think anything about it. I said, because you're nothing to me. You've done that, your numbers are... I said, listen. She said, the reason I'm here more than anything, you're going to kill my husband. I know what you're going to do. Oh. I said, where's the wire? I said, is that what you come to do, is it? I said, that ain't going to happen. I've no interest in you or your woman. I said, you're only two wrong ones anyway. I said, I've helped you, I said, beyond belief. You've had my kids on your knee, I said, and you've tried to get me 30 plus years. I said, what kind of people are you anyway? I said, get me fucking house, you rubbish. I said, you are lucky. You're lucky that I've got a wife and kids, I said. I'll fucking kill a lot of you. You're lucky about that. Anyway, well, I think you're going to do this. I said, fuck off, get out. Anyway, I felt like grabbing her by the neck and fucking throwing up the floor. Yeah, this bastard's cost me 22 months. I could have shut my fist and buried it right in the front of her face, honestly. Yeah, and I've got the missus there getting all upset, you know, because I was half losing it with this woman anyway. Yeah, anyway, put her out the door. Grabbed her by the arm, walked her out the door. I said, fuck off. Yeah, I said, your husband or whatever, I said. But I knew they were... She was probably being wired for sound anyway, so I couldn't really say a lot. Anyway, I'm in bed 10 o'clock at night. Next thing, I've got the fucking police at my door. Yeah? Comes downstairs. You've breached your bail conditions. I said, I ain't breached no bail conditions. Yeah, you have. You should have reported a Stockport police station at 7:30. I said, I was there at 6:30. Well, that's not what we've got. You've got to come with us anyway. You're being rearrested.
Yeah.
Anyway, handcuffs on. Taken to wherever in Manchester. Yeah. In court the next morning. For my barrister to come up from London. And my barrister to say to me, listen, you're free to go. They're just flexing the muscles and basically telling you, you know, if anything happens to them, they're giving you a message. Give it to my barrister from the... to give to me, that if anything happens to them, you'll be added for a conspiracy to whatever, murder, killing them or whatever. Anyway, and that was it. So I went back home and played Happy Families again until I went to the court case, and then we fought all the money laundering case. But I'll tell you another funny spin on all this, yeah? Now, you wouldn't believe this. So, boxing now, years gone by, and I used to see this fella, yeah, regular, you know, and he said to me, and he's talking to me, he went, I've got a secret, he says, and you don't know it. So I thought to myself, yeah, I'm looking at him, yeah, I thought, what is it? Yeah. He says, I'll tell you one day. Anyway, talking to him. Well, one day wasn't long. I think I had a meeting with him a few days' time, whatever. It was probably in fight week at the boxing. This ain't long ago, by the way. And he said to me, my name's such and such a thing, yeah? My father was the presiding judge over your case. How about that? Yeah. Small world, isn't it? Yeah. He said, my dad done your case. So, yeah. And he was a very good man. Listen, he was a judge. Fair man he was. Yeah. And he said to me, I was at Liverpool Crown Court in 2011, 2012, whenever it was. And we'd had a 3-month trial going on there. And he said, I've been with you now, he said, from 2007, maybe all the way through to 2012, this judge. And he said to me, you can see the way it is. He says, and I've listened to you. I've listened to you that much, he said. Your name's going to end up on my epitaph. I didn't know what he meant by that at the time. I didn't know what epitaph meant. But obviously, he was like a very humorous type of judge, you know. Would you say he's heard that much of it? He's going to put my name on his gravestone. So anyway, and he was saying, he says, you are a very intelligent man. And he said, I'm sure you can do good things with your life. And he says, you need to walk away. He said, because next time, he said, life will be life. And I took it on board, and I went out to court, and that's it. I said, that's it, I'm done with all of it.
You knew that was it then? There was no...
And I've just, even with people and everything else, I just said, right, that's it. I looked at my family, because even though I got out on bail with the money laundering, they wanted millions of pounds or whatever. I never had the money. So I was going to get 10 or 14 year in default anyway.
Because of paying the money?
Otherwise, if I couldn't have paid the millions, yeah. So this judge seen through it. I still got a heavy fine, don't get me wrong. But something I could afford, you know. So I paid the fine and that was it. So even though I'd done the 2 years in, fought cases inside, I come out, Liverpool Crown Court, I was fighting it all the way through. And even towards the end, you know, if it would have went the wrong way for me, I was going to get another 10 or 14 anyway. So I wasn't walking out of court. Although I was on bail, you know, I was going to go back down for another 12 or 14 or whatever it was. But I will say this, and I can say this, but a lot of people can't say. When I was looking all them years on that Cat A thing, I'd resided myself to do it. Yeah. And I said to the missus, I said, listen, I'm going to do it. That's what we're going to do. And we'll get on with it. I said, that's the way it is. I said, but there's one thing, I'm sure, I'll go down fighting it to the end. I said, that's all I'm going to do. And I relied on me a bit of faith and stuff. And God must have been looking down on me because I come out of it.
How did freedom feel at that point, knowing that you'd been in, come out, been in, got, and this was it now, you knew that? How did it feel, and what was your thought process for the future at that point?
I just put my mind into other things, and that's it. You know, what I said, I just called everything a day with everything. I'm not saying I was into criminality even before when I come back, you know, but I've, you know, if somebody put a deal to me, I'd have a go at it, you know. So, like, I wasn't, couldn't say a straight member or anything, you know. I'd never do it anything, really. But what I'm saying is, when I come out, when I finish with that court and I come out, that was, I've never looked at any, never looked back. And then you get a bit older and you realise then, it's all a waste of time.
I take it at that point, you went legitimate businesses that you that took up your time, you had to, you know, you went down that road. What did you want to do as far as that? Concerned, because the boxing, it took a while for that to come back into your life, didn't it? The boxing side.
I didn't really do anything, you know. Even on the business side, I just concentrated on the boxing. I was with the young ones and stuff, and and it was therapy for myself as well, because I've got a lot of, listen, when you're somebody, when people need you, that you look, they live off your back, you know. There's a lot of intelligence out there which isn't true, you know. People's collecting debts and putting my name to them I didn't even know about. Yeah, and he said, oh, you know, we paid that money. I said, what fucking money? I thought to myself, yeah, where's mine? But on a serious note, all these things go on. Oh, if you don't pay me, you know, you'll have them there to deal with and all this. So it starts spiraling out of control. Well, you've nothing to do with it anyway. People want to associate themselves with somebody because of who you are and who you're associated with yourself. But I've never run off people's names. I've never used people's name. I probably know some of the most serious people in the country. I don't run off their name. They're just like me, the family people, yeah? And the good people as well. And we're friends, and they're not into no crime as far as I'm aware. You know, they've moved on with their lives like I have. But, you know, they're prominent people, aren't they?
How would prison change you, Peter?
It makes you wise. It makes you wise to a lot of stuff. You see... You see betrayal on its max. But I've been betrayed many times. But the blessed Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed a lot. Look what happened to him. He'd done nothing wrong. You know, Pontius Pilate, he said, I'm washing my hands of it. This man's done no wrong. This is on you yourselves. Use a crucifying this man. So it's in human nature. Go back to biblical days. Human nature will deceive the other one. And And that's how it is. But you know, people of faith and people that genuinely believe in the blessed Lord don't deceive anybody. And they tell the truth. And the truth, there's a true saying, and a lawyer, you know, mentioned this to me, and I always say that, and he said to me, the pen is mightier than the sword. Because the truth don't lie, you know. So, yeah, there's been some good sayings.
So you appreciate more things as well once you get freedom back. What did you appreciate and enjoy, you know, that you didn't maybe before? What did you start to appreciate? You know, obviously, time and your own life, but your family and the kids, and obviously your absence as well. How much of an effect did that have on the family?
You know, it had a big effect. You know, she was a strong woman. Obviously, she was with me when I was younger, so she managed to carry on with the businesses and stuff like that, you know. And I've come out and I've carried on with the boxing, you know, just to keep me right, whatever. I'm not a money person anymore anyway. I've got no interest in it. I had money when I was younger, you know. I'm not destitute now. If I want something, I can go and get it, you know. It doesn't matter to me. Don't judge me on having money or having none. Look at me as nothing. Look at me as like I've got nothing, none. Because that's me. I don't want to be a clever con. I'm not interested. I'm interested in now peace and quiet. The few people I've got around me that I trust, because that's a very big thing to me, knowing what I've been through all my life, that I've been deceived up and down, yeah? And it's cost me my freedom as well. So I've seen all that. So I just want to be around good people that I can trust.
Is it harder to trust people? Or do you get wiser to it?
It don't bother me now, because I don't need to look through my rear view mirror to see if I'm being followed or listened to, because I don't do anything anymore. So it don't bother me. No, I don't look over my shoulder, don't look at anything, because I live right. I live right, I don't do anything, but trust in what regard? Do I really trust a lot of people? No, I don't, because I know the nature. Why would I? Would you? If you was me? So there you are. Look, I'm a well-travelled man. I'm an experienced man. I've seen a lot of comings and goings in every walk of life, more than many. And there's more done more than me. So, I don't know. You can go on forever. But there's one thing. You get older and you get wiser. And all as I want to do now is get these young'uns to where they need to go. Because it's not about me. Listen, you can't tempt me with anything. My happiness is seeing these succeed. You know, lifting their hands when they win major titles or something. You know, you can't buy these type of things. So I'm interested in things that money can't buy. I'm not a materialistic fool. Do you know what I mean? I'm interested in what it means, you know, and where people, you know, respect you for what you've done. That's what I'm interested in more than anything. That's what makes me get up and get in the gym every day. To be loyal to my son, got me great nephew here, you know, and make these do well, because that's what I want to do. That's what I'm interested in. And hopefully they will do well. And they do well in the gym. They're all doing well here.
You've done great as a trainer. I mean, boxing.
That's it, yeah.
Boxing came into your life then, didn't it? I mean, it had been in your life as a young man. You've always had that love of boxing, but then it comes serious. You've got a son there, Yui. He's growing up. He's took a shot. I mean, I think all the kids, they boxed a bit, but Yui stood out. He had this determination.
Yeah, yeah.
Not only the skills. And he gets to an age where he's training, he's losing fights. I think you said at the time you was abroad, and Maureen sent him over to come with you. And Yui told me himself, after being with you a few times, he started winning fights.
Yeah,
the stuff you was telling him was sinking in. He was telling him the right advice. And he realised, I've got my dad here. I'm going to all these trainers. I've got my dad here. He's telling me the right things and I'm winning. And that's where the story and your life into boxing began.
I only ever started doing boxing just to help him in the first place. That was it. And then obviously fighters has come, and you know, and listen, I'm happy to help. And you notice there's no famous ready-made star coming in here. You know, I want to build fighters from where they are. I want to build them from nothing, take them through, develop them, and they win good things.
When did that come to you though? Because you wasn't going to be a trainer. It, like I say, it happened with you. In the next minute, you become a full-time trainer. Do you remember that moment when, actually, I'm going to do this? I know you still have a business, but I'm going to dedicate this much time to...
You know what? I still don't look at myself as a trainer today. Yeah. I've got to tell you.
You've still not made that decision yet.
I just look at where I'm just helping them. You know, I don't know. You know, a trainer, I don't know what that is. There's people that train fighters and, you know, they're there. And I give trainers the eye to respect. It's a hard job it is, you know. And you know, a lot of respect needs to go to the amateur coaches as well, because they don't get seen. You know, they're there in day out with the young fighters, and they need all the credit. You know, the boxing is a lovely sport. And when I say boxing's become a cringe sport in the pros, and a lot of things that go on, you know, I think boxing for me has helped save my life. You know, because when I was a young kid involved in boxing, I never got in trouble. Ever since I've been in boxing, I've never got in trouble. You know, the fighters in the gym, they're not in trouble. They're getting a career for themselves. They're off the streets. So boxing is a very good thing, because ultimately two men's got to get in there and start having a fight, haven't they? And it's a skill, and you know, they need the eye to respect it, like I said, to climb for the rope. So it's a good thing in that respect. I just don't like the politics, because listen, somebody like me, I can see people from a long way away. I'm not fooled by anything. I can even get messages past them. I can read what's being said, and I can fathom out where it's coming from and where it's going to end. So that's where it is. Life knowledge, isn't it? It's experience. But getting the fighters where they want to be, that's the ambitions now. And I want to do interviews like this with yourself. It's basically, you know, get away from all the crime. You know, stop doing the drugs, because drugs, it is killing them. You know, and it is a stain. It's a stain on my life in the past, but I was in it. You know, and listen, at the end of the day, it's wrong. It's killing people. And I don't like people who take drugs. That's another thing. I can't get on with them. Because for me, it's a weakness. I've got reasons why it's a weakness as well. Because even back in the day when I was involved in a lot of things, all these people that took drugs was weak. They'd do damage somewhere. They'd either cost a lot of money, yeah, or they'd fuck up somewhere and it'd be a fucking headache. So what I'm saying to you, whichever way you want to look at it, drugs is bad for young people. I'm talking from a man who's got experience. Don't go there.
You regret getting involved in that?
I regret it. It's a stain on society, to be honest with you. And it is. It's a bad thing. And I'm not trying to make myself right. Listen, if I go to hell, I'll go to hell. Wherever I'm going, I'm going. But that ain't going to change me from telling what I see and being good about it. If I get up today to them, lucky enough to get to the pearly gates, and he says to me, yeah, Peter, you've done that, you've done this, the bad still outweighs the good, you're going down there, that's it, I'm going. I'm still going to be what I am. I'm going to be the person I am. You can't change your past. You can only deal with it and tell people and try and steer them away from it. Like all my kids, they ain't gone into crime.
There is a lot of good people in boxing.
There is, you know, and it turns a lot of people around as well.
Yeah, I suppose you've been in that life of the underworld life, if you like, and you've met a lot of people. You're in boxing, you've met a lot of people. I mean, you know, there's a lot of good people in it.
There is.
You know, you've succeeded in it very, very well. As a coach, there's not many coaches who take the sun from a young amateur who's losing all the time.
To give me that award the other day, especially from the Boxers Association, I respect...
Picture, let's have a look at a picture.
Yeah, I know you've done it for me. What a lovely thing that is. But at the end of the day, I respect that from the old boxing people. You know, to give me that. That means a lot to me, actually. Not look at me. I've got a... What is it called? All of Fame thing.
Trainer of the Year.
Don't mean anything to me. Do you understand? What means something is them old school fighters recognising me and giving me the award for that. That's what means something to me. So that's what I'm very grateful for.
It was a good night, was it?
It was a lovely night.
I came down with you, it was on the table.
I can't thank them enough, you know. I'm very appreciative of that award.
It's well deserved, though. Like I said, there's not many people who take a son from an amateur, your nephew, to the world title fights, and then Savannah Marshall from an amateur to becoming world champion.
And soon to be the unified world champion.
Well, there you go. Now, that's some going, Peter. You know, I know people always say to you, but you came into it and you I know you like to, you say you like to help people, and I suppose you would, if you were still in the car game, you might help people doing that, but you've been boxing, you've helped people achieve dreams.
Well, a lot of these,
to the highest level.
A lot of these conversations we're having, we've had all, you're taking me through my life. So that was a young man back then. This ain't the man today. It's a different man, you know. That's not the man. That was the man back then. This ain't the man I am today, is it? I'm a different man altogether. So, you know, that's why we've gone all through what you've touched on. But basically, the boxing, it's a lifesaver for everybody.
What's the secret to success as a boxing coach? To do that, to take some, you know, family and, you know, your own son to that. I mean, it's sometimes even them family relationships don't work out with coach and father and things like that, but it's worked for you and you've found that winning, that formula, that to train a fighter and not, you know, heavyweight fighters, you've had a lot come to you, but you've took three of them there to the top of the tree.
I don't know. I can't answer it. I cared about the fighter and that's it. And I want the best for him. But I genuinely want the best for the fighter. There's no ulterior motive for me. You know, I want the best for the fighter. Come in here, train, they work hard, and I want to see them do well and be a success for themselves. And that's it. And, you know, when they, it's nice when in years to come and they look back and they say, you know, he had no need to help me, but he helped me. And, you know, look what happened. So if you can do that, it's not just me. I'm not no Einstein or whatever. But people need maximum respect to genuinely want to help people and do good. And that's it. And I think that's why we're successful. Because obviously I know boxing. I'm not an idiot, you know. But basically, I think the thing is, you want to do your best. You know, and that's it. And I don't like messing around. I've been a serious person all my life, so I'm not a... don't like come train. If you've got it in you and you really want it and you're passionate about it, then I want to, if I can help somebody realize that dream, then it's a big plus for me. You know, that's what I'm happy about. I don't need the applause for it. I want to see them become world champions, whatever they're doing, and I'll just drift off back to my house and get on my wine, you know. Get on me a couple of bottles, or maybe three or four or whatever.
No, I'm not. You're not someone to say, "Oh, I'm proud of what I've done here," or anything like that. I know you wouldn't do that. It's like you said. It's the people who, if they appreciate it, that's all that counts to you. The things that money can't buy: your health, peace of mind, and a thanks now and again that you've helped someone along the way and you've done something that didn't take money to do that.
Well, listen, you know, you do your stuff and you do your best every day, and that's it. I respect hardworking people because, and we're all the same. You know, there's people with all kinds of problems out there. There's people with addictions. There's people with whatever problems is going on. It's not an easy ride. There's no easy ride. I don't have easy rides myself. Some days it's up, some days it's down. But, you know, we ride with the waves and we just keep going. And that's it. But there's no easy solutions to life. It's a hard life. But when you expect a hard life and you've gone through that, then everything really, you know, it's not a problem.
You got a tough core about you, Peter. You had to do what you've done in the past. You know, being a boxing coach is all you've got to have that. When you when you're coaching people who are close to you and family and like Savannah and the other April who become close to you, and you've got to be a really hard taskmaster. You've got to be tough. You've got to watch them go through so much pain in training for weeks on end, let alone on fight night, and you're watching the tears and the blood and. How does that sit with you when you become so close to these people and it's blood as well?
What you've got in boxing, when everything's going right, it's everybody's patting me on the back, aren't they? Whatever. When it goes wrong, though, you see all the demons come out the woodwork. And, you know, I think when I seen Savannah box and she lost the fight with Clarissa Shields, I was looking in the background who really wanted her to lose. And I was looking at who was, you know, and that showed me all about what's in boxing today. That's why this is a close-knit gym, yeah? And I don't want to be Mr. Fucking Popular, yeah? Because I know all them pricks out there, yeah? wanted a young woman, wishing her all the harm in the world.
You could see this from...
Yeah. I can see it. And let me tell you something, it wasn't good. So that's what I don't like about human nature. It gets back to the betrayal scenario, doesn't it? In the prisons and all of that, where I've lost my freedom for these motherfuckers anyway. Yeah? And let me tell you, there's not a man amongst them. There ain't a real man amongst them. They can't face death, these fuckers. Do you know what I mean? They ain't lived a life like I've lived. Do you know what I mean? If my days are going to end, they're going to fucking end. Don't worry about it. But they can't. They're not proper soldiers, these. These are clowns. Where they're jealous of other people. That's what they are. So, getting back. So that's what I don't like about boxing. Now, you know me when I see a boxer fight. Yeah? I hope they win. I hope they win. Do you know what I mean? They train hard and, you know, and I comment on fighters, you know, and you want them to do well and you want them to win. And if they've made mistakes, I'll say, well, in my opinion, you've done that wrong, because I want them to look at what I've said and correct it. Because in my way, when I explain when a fighter's lost and I start saying what I think they've done wrong, I hope they're going to read it, look at it and correct it and say, well, look, he's saying that and I'll get on and do this next. That's why I speak about it. So it ain't condemning them. Get it right next time, because you can get it right next time. They say you prepare, they say you deal with a loss, you know, it's not really a loss. You learn from it. You learn from it, you take things from it, you grow from it. Feed off problems. Don't let problems ruin you and put you in the ground. Feed off it. Use it for fuel. Come back strong and say, listen, motherfucker, I'm punching your fucking face in. That's what you're getting next time out. Get a backbone, get on it. That's life. Because you ain't got that mentality, don't come in a boxing gym. Don't be here to come second best or have participated. Fuck off with the participating. Yeah? You're here to win. You're here to win. Got two arms, two legs. I couldn't care who it is. Yeah? Two arms, two legs. Remember that. Everybody's beatable. You got to have that. You got to instill that mentality into the fighter. And if they believe that, they're winning. You know? And sometimes they can believe it and lose because they come up short because the technique ain't so good. Because the level of opponent you step to, yeah, they've studied and got the job better. So nothing's a guarantee. That's why I keep saying, let's have 50-50 fights. Because we see where the creases are. The cracks only appear, don't they? Yeah? When the right pressure comes. Anybody can deal with an idiot, can't they? Deal with somebody on your same level. See what it's like. It's life, isn't it? Whichever way you look at it.
Do you get to see that with certain boxers you've worked with a lot over the years, that they could have everything, but there might be little things missing? So, for instance, like you said there, you know, going through defeat, it's how you would come back from that that would determine what type of character they are. Or, you know, do you know when a boxer's got it? Do you know when there's certain things, you know, that no matter how they might go do so far, but they've got that little thing that they won't take it to that next level, you know, be it not necessarily the skill, but, you know, on the night, and these other things mentally and I might come into, you know, you've got to take a lot of things, mix them together and get that product, yeah, that boxer,
look,
out of
it. It's a work in progress, you know. The fighter's got to speak as well. It's a two-way street.
Good communication.
You've got to have good communication. They've got to speak and they've got to say what the problems are. And then you speak about it, you remedy it. That's it. You know, you've got to be a mind reader. You've got to be a lot of things. But you've got to know the fighter. And you work on all the pitfalls. Don't work on the good things. Work on the bad things. And make them good to go with the good things.
You've not done too bad as a boxing coach, have you, Peter? You've done very well.
You know, listen, there's a lot more to come. And, their success is my success. Because you're saying I've done very well. But it's only because of the fighters. So where would I be without the fighters? So, see what I mean?
Yeah.
So when they do well, I do well. I'm happy with being in the gym and guiding the fighters. You know, that's it. And but it does take up a lot of my time. It takes up a lot of my time, and I want to see the fighters through what I've got, and then when they reach where they're going, you know, I'll have to have a reassess of it. you know, because I can never say, but listen, when I'm in here and I switch off, I'm involved in it. You know, so I've not read a book about boxing, or I think if you know something, you know something. And you just impart your knowledge and what you know to the fighter. And that's it. You know, but for me, there's a lot involved in boxing. But it's like my son now. He's back, he's in training now, and I'll just give him a few pointers, you know, where he's a little bit rusty and stuff. I'll say, just do that and do that. Because he got that much knowledge up there. They know everything anyway. So you can just, it's a lot easier. It's a lot easier working with a high experienced fighter, because he's gone through all the pitfalls, they've gone through all the mental stuff, you know, so you can go through it. And then I look at somebody on the beginning stage, you know, and then it's like, it puts me back 5 or 10 years ago when I'm dealing with them, you know, but it steps. But I still enjoy doing that with them, because it's good for them to get it and guide them. And it's bits and pieces. There is nobody coming in here and getting what I'm going to tell you in 6 months. Boxing is not that. When you're taking young fighters on, it's a long time. You know, it's building, building, building. It's small steps all the time. And as long as they're progressing and they're working out the flaws, that's it. And this is why they should fight regular.
Is there any end game in the boxing for you, Peter, at the moment? Is it when Yui retires? I presume that'd coincide with around the same, maybe the same time as Savannah might retire, but you've got others coming through. You've got young James over here, your nephew. April is coming through now, making a career for herself. So, you text them so far, and then someone else comes back through on the conveyor belt, which means, you know, that time that you said away from boxing, you haven't got much, but you've got more time in the gym.
Obviously, my brother Jimmy is my brother, you know, he's my brother, he's my family, you know, he died too young. So at the end of the day, I've got his grandson here. So I've got a duty there. And I know my brother Jimmy loved boxing, and he used to turn up and watch my son. He'd sit there at that ringside and he'd watch him. And I had to go and get him, arm round him, where he'd be drunk, yeah, and waltz him up and put him to bed in an hotel somewhere. But he'd be there, you know, and he'd say to me, oh, when's Yui fighting, this and that. You know, so, you know, I can imagine as well what it would mean to him to see this young lad do well here. You know, because he's my brother, isn't he? So I look at him like he's my son anyway. Same blood as me, isn't he? He's my boy, isn't he, really? So my brother's lad, isn't it? Brother's grandson. So it's the same thing. So yeah, he's here. So I want to make sure I'm going to turn him over at 20. He'll box till he's at 20. When he's 18 in November. He's 18 in November. So then he box, turn professional, and he'll do his thing. And, you know, look, from a young lad living on a gypsy site with nothing, you know, he's got a future. He's got a future. And I'm an uncle that's going to give him one. Make no mistake. I don't leave my people behind. I take them with me. And they can be my family. They can be a stranger down the road. I don't leave my people behind. They come with me. And they've always been with me, Chris, anyway. I don't leave my people behind, ultimately. Never.
You're a good man, Peter. You're a good man. Yeah, family means a lot to you. Have you got grandchildren, Peter?
I have. I've got four.
Granddad, four.
Granddad, yeah. Old man, innit? Granddad. Done. Slippers, plenty of wine down my neck. That's it. The lid of the box is opening, isn't it? It's creaking open. Oh,
don't remind us.
The screws have been took out of it. It's coming. So yeah, what do I want to give? What do I really care about? Could end, couldn't it? At any time.
Do you think about that? Do you think about death and our own demise?
Of course.
I mean, when you get to a certain age, I was saying this to someone the other day, you start going to more funerals. You know, as you get older, people start passing away, you just want, you know, and life changes.
I'll tell you what I see with funerals, yeah? People turn up to funerals, yeah, and they weep around that grave. And when they go home, that's it. They have the burger and chips. Yeah? You know, when I care about people, I care about them forever. They're in your heart, aren't they? You don't need to turn up to a funeral or whatever, how I think about people. Because I believe in the afterlife. I solely believe in Jesus Christ, and that's me. Yeah. And I know where they all are. And I know I'll be going and seeing them, like I said, if I don't go down rather than up. You know, I'll have to shout and ask them for a rope to pull me up or something. You know, but on a serious note, that's what I believe in. So there's no death. The skin tissue, that's nothing. Your soul moves on. And I do believe that. I believe it more than I'm sat here.
In reincarnation, we come back.
No, I don't believe in none of that shit. I think that's shit to me.
What do you believe in?
I'm not saying it's shit. That's my belief. I think it's rubbish. I believe your spirit becomes free and you go into a higher realm. And I believe there's a heaven, you know, and I do believe that.
You've had a lot of grieving in your life, parents, family, friends. How do you deal with grief?
Look, I've lost people, you know. I've seen young people get burned to death. I've seen people, you know, they're not here. You know, they've been killed or whatever. You know, I've got a family around me now where I've seen little kids grow up with no dad, where they've never found a dad. You know, he's never been seen again. You know, gone. Family's ripped apart, don't know where the husband is. He's gone. He's never been found either. So all of these things, I've seen all this.
A lot of things.
I've seen a lot of stuff. I've seen a hell of a lot of stuff. You know, years ago. Here, I'll give you an instance. And the fella's alive today. And if he's looking at this, and he'll know it's him, because I'm not going to mention any names again. I'm in Spain, goes to a villa. Yeah? Anyway, I'm knocking on the door, yeah? Because I know him. I knew him. Anyway, next thing. And it had cameras on it. So I goes back to the car, and next thing. Fella pops his head out. He says, Peter. Yeah. He said, come in. And he goes in. There's this Jeep pulled in. And I've looked in the back and it's all done out with plastic. Yeah. In the back of it. It goes in. He's only there sat on a seat. And he's dying. When I say dying, he's about to have his head blown off. The two people in the I used to go, he used to do the horses, this fella, yeah? Like, on the bed and stuff. Anyway, I used to go and see him, have a bit of crack with him and stuff. Let's just go and see him. Anyway, so I knew the waiters, I knew the servants he had and the housekeepers. They're tied up and bound upstairs, yeah? There's 10 people in that room, yeah? And they've lost 1.8 million. Down to him. Yeah? And he said, basically, he's Peter, well, this is what's happened. Yeah. And have you got anything to say to him or whatever? Because that's it. So I said, well, surely, I said, have you asked him for an explanation? I said. He said, well, what's the point of it? We've lost the money, haven't we? We're not going to get it back. He said, but he's never going to spend it, is he? Yeah. But I knew in my heart and soul that he wasn't about that. So I then said, hey, hang on a minute, yeah. I said, you're making the judgments. I said, I understand you've lost a lot of money, yeah. I said, but you're making these judgments on this fella. I said, I can tell you, I know this fella, and he ain't that. Yeah. And the one fella said to me, oh, he said, yeah. He said, we can see what's happening here. You come up here, he said, he's your pal, he said, and you've got some connection there. He said, at the end of the day, Peter, he said, you're trying to save him, he said, forget all that, we're not interested. He's going, yeah? So anyway, who's that? Having arguments back and forth. Now, bearing in mind, these are tooled up, they've got guns at the ready, yeah? They've got good shoulder guns and, you know,
ready to do it.
They're ready to go. There's an army of them in the house, they've sieged the house, it's like a siege going on. Yeah?
And you've just walked into this.
And I've walked into this and I'm arguing to save his life. He's lucky, he's one very lucky man that I drove past there. And they come out because they seen me on the camera. And I went in. And I pleaded with his life with them for a good 2 hours. And he was like, I think it was like when I was talking to him, he couldn't hear me. because he was convinced he was going. I thought he's going, to be fair. I was doing my best for him. And in the end, he said, look, are you going to guarantee him? I said, let me tell you something, yeah? I said, what is it, 1.6 million? I said, I'll bet you 2 fucking million, how's that, that he ain't done it. I said, if he's done it and he's responsible, I owe you 2 million quid. So I said, now, why do you want to kill him now? He said, are you fucking stupid? He said, this fucker, he's took our money, it's gone up the road, we've ended up with a box of tiles for merchandise, yeah? And they've done the money, and it's on his recommendation. I said, he tries to help everybody. I said, because he was a money mover, yeah? He's moving money up and down. I said, him there, I said, he ain't that. I said, trust me on it. I said, give the follower a break. I said, listen, I don't want to see it, I said, if you're going to do it, I said, understand. I said, this is the game they play. I said, whatever. I said, I'm going to stand it. I said, but he ain't done that. I said, no, I don't agree with it. Tell you now, I don't agree with it. So I said, yeah. And it was like, wow. there was a standoff. There was like silence. Yeah. And he's like this, he's got the gun and he's doing like, scratching his head. And he's looking at him. And I said to this fella, I said, stop looking at him. I said, you're winding yourself up, mate. I said, you know when you pull that trigger? I said, his life's gone. I said, yeah, but I've got satisfaction. He's waving up and down. And there's a few of them there. And look, it's like a pack of wolves, but a pack of dogs together. You know, you get eaten alive. And it was like this. You know, when he spoke, he was backing him up and saying, listen, we lost the money. What does it fucking matter? Forget the money. You know, this will make an example. We'll go after the money anyway. Yeah. So it was all of that. So like it was a mission, but I won the debate. I won the debate.
Like it was a high tension one as well. That one.
It was a high tension, yeah. And I won the debate, and he's alive today.
Right. Did the right thing then.
And I was right.
Someone had you walking past there that day.
Yeah, and I was right because he didn't have anything to do with that. You know, how many people would say how many people go in there and be a nodding dog and really fight his corner? How many people would do that? Very many, is there? That's what I mean.
Not many would have the balls to do that either.
No, but I knew him, and he was my friend. I valued him. And that's another reason I've walked away from everything and everything to do with that, because there's no feeling there for people. I couldn't do that, you know. I said, fuck's sake, I said, look at him. I said, you know, before you pull the trigger, I said, he's dead anyway, look at him. That's what you've done to him. You know, give the man a break. Anyway, and they never done it. And some years later, they spoke to me and they said, you know, you was right. You know, he was hot-headed and, you know, you calmed the situation down because he wouldn't have been here.
They might have not been either if you saved them from...
possibly, yeah. But he was very, very close. Very close. It's a good job I knew him because they didn't know him. Not as well as I did. They knew him. Obviously, they knew him to trust him with money or whatever, you know, but they didn't know him like I knew him. And I vouch for him because I know him. I said, he wouldn't do that. I said, he's not somebody who robs people.
It was a close shave. Yeah. Yeah, you look at the crossroads of life and sliding doors where you can go one way, you can turn left or turn right or go forward or turn back, and it takes you in a totally different...
So listen, I've done some bad things in my life and I've done some good things. I've saved a few people's lives as well. And I've been involved in crime myself in the past, which ain't good. No crime's good.
Growing old comes wisdom, comes worries, more worries, grey hair, wrinkles, you know, but...
I've even got grey hairs coming out of my ears.
Oh, it's bad when they can't come out of the ears.
Not everywhere.
But, you know, you look at life like that and you look back on the decades of your life and the decisions you've made and, like I say, turning left or turning right has took you where you are now. So, you know, is there things you would have changed, or do you look at it like that? Do you look at
where you... Yeah, I'd change a lot of stuff if I had my time over again. I'd have saved misery. I'd have saved 10 years inside or, you know, and fighting cases and all this, you know. So it's all unnecessary. a lot of stuff is self-inflicted. It's the avenue you take. So I respect everybody. I respect a man who's never been in trouble in his life, because I respect that, because he's not been in trouble. You know, that needs to be respected, because they've listened and there are some good law-abiding people out there. There's all kinds of people. I respect everybody. I can't judge anybody. Look at my, look where I've come from. Who am I going to... I'm not on anybody's eye horse, am I? I'm probably the realest person there is on the planet. You know, because I've been there. I've worn the T-shirts inside and out 10 to 20 times. But, you know, we are where we are. What can we do with anything? Listen, I buried a very, very close friend of mine the other day. And I watched him go down the hall. His missus went down 6 months previously. He went down there. And I think to myself, you know, what, what is he? So I just want to do well for these. And to be honest with you, if my clocks kick up and that's the end of it, that's the end of it. And I don't want a lot of pretenders at my funeral. Yeah. I want the people who love me to be there. Nobody else. Yeah. And there'll be a lot of people around the world that have got respect for me and just say prayers for me and fight me corner when I either I'm going down or going up. Say, listen, let the poor fucker go up. I'd rather them do that than go to a funeral and pretend a lot of shit.
What are you most proud of?
I'm proud of my fighters and I'm proud of my family and my friends who have known all my life and been there for me. Yeah. That's it. I like good people. That's it. I'm a kind fella. You know, I'm not a bad person. I don't screw people. I'm not a sly cunt. You know, I'm just straight down the line. That's what you get. And I treat people all the same. I don't care if you've got 10 pence. I know people who ain't got 10 pence. And I know billionaires. And they're all friends of mine. So I don't stigmatize anybody.
Treat everyone the same.
We're all the same.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, you got millions of pounds and you're in a box.
Don't matter, does it?
Well, who's interested
in that?
Playing
millionaires
in
a cemetery.
Yeah, exactly. Better to be happy. I sort of always said it, peace of mind and being contented and having your health, you're a billionaire anyway.
Amen.
Amen, yeah, true.
Is there something you wish you would have done in your life that you hadn't done? Something you wish you'd tried or gone down a different road?
Probably not. The life I've took it. I've done the paths and that's it. I ain't one to look back and think, oh, you know, I wish I hadn't have done this, I wish I hadn't have done that. It's done. Can't change it. I am what I am. And that's it. Not trying to be anybody. I'm not looking to be knighted or anything, am I? Not going to have dinner with a king or anything. Listen, we are what we are. Tread paths and we do our own thing. But I respect everybody. It can be the royal family, I respect them. The old queen, God love her, you know. A God-fearing woman, I respect that. I respect all Christian people anyway. Anybody believes genuinely in the blessed Lord, I've got all time for them in the world because they've got the same beliefs as me, haven't they? So we're all interconnected and you can be any faith, Muslim or whatever, same for me. Believe in the blessed Lord, that's it. You know. We're all the same.
And the future, Peter, achievements and things like that, do you look at them kind of thing? I know with the boxers, you want to achieve their dreams, which ultimately are, you know, will be achievement for you. But, you know, personally in life, do you look at it like that? Or are you just happy that the family's growing up, the kids are growing up, everyone's healthy and stuff like that? Or personally, do you look at it and think, well, I wouldn't mind doing that in my life. I'm going to do that. You know, like you say, the boxers have ambition. What's your ambition for the future?
Ambition is to have a bit of peace and like you said, all the kids get married, have kids and be happy and let them get good lives. That's it. There's nothing more to be done from that, is there? What can I have? Peace of mind is what I want to achieve more than anything. We all want to have that peace of mind, don't you? We ain't got to wake up in the morning and worry about anything. So I'm not there yet. So that's what I work towards, peace of mind, nothing else. If God spares me and I keep healthy, then I'll keep going. See where we get to. I've I've got unfinished business in boxing, so I'm going to keep going.
What's the unfinished business? What do you want to do?
I've got to get Yui to where he's going. Savannah, a few fighters I've got around me here. I want to deal with them. And then that's it.
What happens after that?
Sit down, drink tons of wine. Yeah. Probably go to 25 stone or something. Watch television. Go walking with a dog. I don't know. I'll have to have a look. I'll have peace of mind though, won't I? So whatever I'm doing, as long as I've got peace of mind, I don't care. I can live in my own company. I don't need company anyway. I can quite sit down, look at the television, and look at the clocks with the clock ticking. Because I'm big on clocks. I've got a lot of Victorian clocks in. And I can listen to that. So I'm happy in my own space. The days can pass for me. Do you know what I mean?
Get rid of the television. I wouldn't recommend that.
Television's a shit. There's nothing on it.
I don't have advert TV.
I press all them Sky channels, yeah, and look at the films. There's nothing on there.
Take it off.
I've seen all the good films, you know. So.
Have you enjoyed doing this, Peter? Have you enjoyed looking back? And how often do you look back on yourself personally? Do you look
I
back
just look
on
back on the main thing for me, what I look back on is the loss of family. I think of my family that's not here. That's the main thing. I look back on that. Forget the hardship, forget everything. I look back on the loss of life that I've had with family and the close friends I've had as well. That's what I look back on. That's what I really miss.
Looking at life through Peter Fury's eyes at 50-odd to his eyes at 20-odd, what's the difference and what do you see different now?
One was an idiot and now one's a man. That's it.
What would you have told that young lad if you had 5 minutes with him now?
Back then?
If you could have him, yeah.
All stupidness.
Don't do it.
Creating problems.
Would you have warned him or would you have, you know, because where you are now, would you feel like to go through them experiences or would you have warned him and, all right, maybe do that. That's an experience you can learn from, but certainly not that one.
Well, you don't need to learn from experiences if you can take good advice, do you?
Learn from others. That's one good, yeah, absolutely.
You know, that's why we're older people. That's why you're a father. That's why when you get to my age, you know, people should listen to people. You should listen to your elders anyway, because they've treaded your path. They've probably treaded a more path than you have. Just because they're old, they think, oh, what does he know? We've all done, and especially me, I've done probably more serious things than a lot of people. So you listen to good advice. You're only ever going to pack good advice. But I can't waste my time as well on somebody that's not going to take good advice. So I'll advise and do the best I can. But then my conscience is clear because you can't get a fully grown woman or a fully grown man and say, you can't do this. You can't do that. Life's not about that, is it? You can't force your will upon somebody. If they don't want to do it, they don't want to do it. So you can only advise them. So you can only hope they take the advice. My father tried to advise me. I didn't take it. My wife advised me. I didn't take it. So, and I'm here through a fluke, let me tell you. Listen, the blessed Lord must have had an answer for me for something else because I shouldn't be here. I've had 4 or 5 assassination attempts where guns have jammed, they've gone off or whatever, yeah? And I've had lots of things go on, other things as well. But honestly, shouldn't even be here. Or I'd have been doing a life sentence because I wouldn't have stopped at anything back then. So it would have been me or somebody else. So I'd have been looking at a green door for the rest of my days. And there's different kind of prisoners as well. Somebody like me, if I got a life, I'd never get out. I'd never, ever, ever get out. There'd be no chance of parole. I'd be going nowhere. I could get 7 years with an IPP. That might as well be 37. I'll die in there, do you know what I mean? I ain't getting out. Some people can get a life sentence and they'll get out. Some people just ain't going to happen. It's not going to happen like that. So it's all about everybody's different. Everybody's viewed as different. It's a different way of going on. But it's all... We can talk about these stories and people go, wow, and look at that, you know, these crime stories and whatever they are, because although they've happened, they're still stories, aren't they? And people, for some reason, like, listen to them. But when you're on the receiving end and you're the one telling it, yeah, it's not funny. Because you've had to go through the misery of it. But whose fault is it? Your own fault. Nobody else's. That's why I don't blame anybody. It's my own doing. Don't blame the motherfucker that snitched me up and got me a 10 stretch and I was good to him. No, I blame myself because I was a bad judge of character. Do you understand?
Yes.
It's all you, not them. Don't look at other people and look at your own surroundings and blame other people for your own doings because it's you yourself. Well, how many people trust people and they turn out to be no good? Mm-hmm. How many people marry wives and they turn out to be no good? The shagging the next door neighbour. How many? The men as well turn out to be no good. How many? Society, isn't it? Mm-hmm. That's why you need to take a step back and try and look for the diamonds rather than going on a coal heap. You know? Get your shovel and your pickaxe. Start fucking digging for quality.
What is the success to a long-term marriage? You've been with Maureen since she was 14. You've been through some right ups and downs together. Only in the what we've talked about tonight, let alone
there, because
else.
You know what? You know when you really love somebody and you're connected to them? You die for them. That's it. It ain't rocket science. It ain't rocket science. You think I'm ever going to betray somebody that's put their life there in prison, done everything, raised me children and done the best for them. I've been the best mother under the sun. Yeah? She's already the God's ear with me anyway. She's at the side of me there. That's how I look at my family. Do you understand? As strong as my faith, so it's my family, isn't it? So that's what I'm saying. That's why I guide my own kids, get somebody properly. Easy to rush in. Listen, to know somebody properly, it takes years. Yeah? You might be very lucky, meet somebody in 6 months. There could be a diamond in the rough. Or you could come completely unstuck and get a right fucking lemon. So that's where we are.
Yeah, you need to suck a few
lemons. You know what I could do with these interviews? I could choose my words a bit more milder, couldn't I, yeah, Chris? I could be a bit more, how do you say, placid or whatever.
not at all. I think you are who you are, Pete. And
ain't going to change now in my 50s, am I?
No.
You are what you are. Prison ain't changed me. Nothing's changed me. I've changed myself. And if anything, listen to the missus, has changed me, but there's nothing else going to do. Good comes over everything. Good comes over evil 7 days a week.
God bless Pete. Have you enjoyed it?
Yeah, it's been good talking to you.
It's a late one.
I don't look at it as an interview. I look at it as me and you having a chat. Yeah. So I can talk for England. I always enjoy it with you, Chris. You're a good pal of mine, aren't you?
We've done it for a long time, haven't we?
We have.
And I appreciate you doing that. Being loyal to me, if you like. And every time I ever ring, you can get down here. I don't even have to ask almost.
Well, you've answered your own question, didn't you, about loyalty and respect. Can you buy loyalty and respect anywhere? Mm. You can't buy it. It ain't for sale. There's no price on it. Mm. There's no price on it being good and good with people, is there?
No. Well, I respect that, Peter. And
well, yeah, respect for you, likewise. Yeah. So, yeah, I've enjoyed it, tell Kerry. And I enjoy these actually. I listen to it.
Yeah.
I listened to it on the way down, coming down the motorway.
Oh, did you?
Got the earphones in and listened to it.
Yeah. But finally, Peter, if we were to make a donation on your behalf to a charity, what would that be?
Anything that helps young children. And, you know, and parents could do with being better parents, mm-hmm. because there's all the shit going on. And I don't want to bring up this gender thing, but I'm going to bring it up. I always do. I think it's wrong. You know, a girl's a girl and a boy's a boy. When they get older and they want to do what they want to do, fine. Don't mess with little children.
You've been talking about that. I joked earlier about the Twitter and everything, but you have been putting some serious points. So when did you start hearing about all that yourself?
I'm not drunk when I say them. When I tweet about children, I definitely ain't. I'm not in my sane mind. I've had a drink now. I've not even drank that water. I say the same thing. Don't mess with the children. Little children, mate. Kind of mother and father, are they?
Oh, I've seen all sorts, Peter, myself. And
I've got school teachers inbox me. Mm. Yeah.
What's going on in the schools? What
surgeons, doctors, everybody else about it. And they said, you know, it's almost affecting what our beliefs are, the things that we see. And they asked us to perform, even surgeon stuff. I haven't gone into it with them, but I can imagine what it is. At the end of the day, what is society coming to? You're born either as a boy or a girl, aren't you? There is a difference, isn't there? Got two eyes in your fucking head, haven't you? One's a girl, one's a boy, isn't it? So what are you doing?
Yeah, Well, if they dig your bones up in 100 years, they'll still know if you was a boy or a girl, won't they?
100%, yeah. Take a DNA sample. Yeah. Anyway, that's all I'm going to say on that. But
yeah. Well, we'll speak about that again and we'll have a good chat. I'm sure we'll be back here again soon, Peter, to see you. We've got loads of fights coming up. Savannah's got a world title fight. She's moving up in weight to fight, what's her name? Cruz, isn't it? Yeah.
Franchon Cruz.
Yeah, great fight. Again, she's come off that loss to Clarissa Shields, but she was straight into a big fight. So you've got that.
Savannah don't need to say a lot. And listen, she's not going to say anything. The way she's come on, you know, she's getting better all the time. And I'm sitting here and I'm very confident. Very confident because she's worked on the flaws, identified what they are, and she's worked on them. And that's it. Listen, when you have a loss, yeah, come back better. Don't have a loss and let's get in there and see the same fucking fighter. Doing exactly the same shit and same thing they did last time. Because they're going to get beat again. Let's see a different fighter. Let's see a better fighter. That's what I'm here to do. Turn her into a better fighter. She's already got it there. It's up to me to put the flaws, what I see, and change them. And that's what we've done.
Have you seen a difference since that loss and coming back?
There's a difference in a mindset. There's a difference in everything. Because now you've got like a seasoned professional who knows exactly what it's all about. You know, now it's a different ball game. So it's better for her. It's better for her because she's took the loss, had a look at it, yeah, and she's coming back twice as strong. Look, she wasn't hurting the fight, what she had. You know, she just pushed it. You know, and there's a few things that was wrong there. But we've worked on it, we've analysed it, and we've worked on them things. And she's corrected them. And she's corrected them to a high degree as well. So we'll see a big difference.
Yeah, you think she's been there on the highest level. She's come through it. She knows what it's all about. It gives you a different perspective on it,
you know,
doesn't
look,
it? Going back in
Clarissa
again.
Got pushed all the way. Fighters can talk, yeah. And that's their makeup. That's their psyche, what they do. They need to do that. But deep down, at the end of that fight, they both had a hard tussle. A very hard tussle. Yeah. And like I say, Savannah, has worked on them flaws. Well, let's get this fight out the way and let's get the other fight back on.
Clarissa, that's the one.
Yeah, of course it is.
Yeah.
There's nobody else.
Yeah.
But look, Franchon Cruz ain't getting overlooked. She's a serious fighter. Mm. She's just a serious fighter, Clarissa.
She is.
She's a bigger weight and she's a good fighter. So nothing's overlooked there. It's a proper 50-50 fight. That's what we want to see anyway. But if I want to be have a big ego where I want to be the best trainer in the world and I'm terrified of defeat and I want to pad the records up, we can all do that, can't we? But listen, when my fighter lost, I give the other fighter maximum credit. I ain't a sore loser because life's about losing and winning. That's the sport we're in, isn't it? That fighter's trained just as hard as my fighter. Yeah, I want my fighter to win. But I'll respect that other fighter if they can beat my fighter. Because I know what they've had to go through to beat my fighter, isn't it? They're all young people. They're all boxers. So why would I be funny about it? Why would I be upset about it? I'm not upset about it. I'm a sportsman at the end of the day. I want her to hopefully beat Cruz, yeah, and get the fight on. And we've remedied what we've worked on, and we'll get the fight on again. Because fighting to me is water off that window. Do
you
your
win
best.
Some, you lose some. It's,
yeah. Put your best foot forward. You're fighting the best.
On that level, it's small margins as well. There's not much in it.
Yeah, she goes back. Small margins.
Yeah. She goes back next
I
time.
I said before, he
win.
Fought. Savannah's never fought anybody on that level, and she's never fought anybody really on Savannah's level either. So it was a good fight for both of them. So let's see. We'll see the rematch. Hopefully.
It's like destiny, and it seems destined to happen again. It will.
God willing, we get this fight on and very silently confident with everything. And we'll see. We're going to see a different side to Savannah than what you've seen in the past. Not rocket science. Yeah. I'm not going to change the DNA of a fighter. She is what she is. But we've corrected about three or four things, which on the world level is a lot. You know, where's she going wrong? Stuff like putting her feet down, short range fighting, mid-range, long range. You know, you've got to be good at it all rather than just being good at a few things.
I'm looking forward to seeing her back in there.
And it'd be good to see the progress, and that's what I look forward to, seeing the progress, yeah.
This is a good fight. Really good fight, this next one.
It's a good fight. We're not messing around, are we?
No, not at all.
So, not taking a joke and
running
around the ring and fought a potato can.
Yeah, a takeover. Yeah, none of that.
Oh, we're going to get back and build up. Build up to what? Build up to nothing. Yeah, Yui can have a build up. He's been 2 years out and he's been not well. He's going to have a build up. He's coming back. And who's he going to fight? What's he going to do? Say, run around the ring with his arms up like he's fought a world champion. I'm going to get him somebody who's a tough nut, can throw punches, some domestic fighter out of Europe somewhere. So I'll have a look.
Once he's...
Yeah, I'm not going to get him a killer world champion, am I? 2 years out.
Dust the cobwebs off,
He needs to dust himself off and he needs to get back into it. And I don't need a big knockout for 3 or 4 rounds. He could do a go in at least 6 to 8, 10 round fight, whatever we can get for him. Somebody that can ship some stick. So yeah, that's the process for Yui, and then he's back.
And then he'll be right in the mix. A couple of fights, he's right in that mix.
He's right in the mix, yeah. That's the thing. Get this fight out the way now, he's going to be having. And get him in. He wants another one, quick and sharp, and then probably a big one at the end of the year or as soon as he can get it.
Saw him before. He's looking healthy, looking well.
Yeah, we're not gonna hang around with Yui. You know, he's gonna get in, and whoever the top fight is, and then it's sensible, we'll take it.
Brilliant. Looking forward to seeing him back in there. Well, Peter. Yeah. Thank you. You're a gentleman. It's always great to speak to you, and appreciate you doing all this time with me tonight.
No problem, anytime. You're welcome.
I'll see you again soon. God bless, Pete.
And you, Chris. God bless you.
In the winter, it was bitterly cold. We had to wee in a bucket. And my dad was a hard, hard man, which everybody was. Every man was. You know, don't forget, they'd all been to the war. Fill up now, you know what I mean? And I was a great electrician in the respect of, how are we going to get up there? I'll get up there. And he gave us some money, Dennis Law. And it was like, wow. And we went and got something to eat. I worked in Guyana. I built a bridge across the Demerara River. Congressman Ryan got shot dead. And they made a big poison. And 900 plus people committed suicide. And I looked down, and in one of the gutters, it was a dead body. And Sam went right, Frankie went left, and they were shooting live ammunition. But I did a little bit too much of that. And then I ended up getting a name that don't mess with Kerry. A week later, they'd found Mike Tyson. And Chris, I can talk now, Chris put a gun to his head. Police estimated he was doing 80 mile an hour. I was doing 30 mile an hour, and he hit me head on. I'm emotional now. I put my arms around him and said, they've had to cut your leg off, mate. They've had to cut your leg off. I started going to Vegas with Ricky and having a right good laugh and enjoying myself 24-7, the Mayweather and all that. I started playing. We weren't made to feel welcome. We were not made to feel welcome. That's the best way I can say it. And I thought, Kerry, that was pretty good, mate. I was satisfied. Could satisfaction and happiness be the same thing?